the circus trying to find us out. But if you're looking for the truth, you can find it out. NASA, I can't go to space, so we hit the roof. Get it, hit the roof. And it all came to light with 200 proofs. Ooh. Now I'm just really sick of people lying to me. So when I tell the truth, don't come crying to me. Pick up the phone, get on the line with me. Line with me. Who you gonna call? Who you gonna call?
And welcome, everybody, to Globebusters, the impossible mainstream gravitational model. I am your host, Bob Xanadude60, and we are back with another great show for you today. And today we're going to be talking about something that I think a lot of people really need to differentiate when they are talking about the so-called gravitational model. And that is what we can actually experience, measure, see, feel, here on Earth, and what the mainstream scientism model is, as far as what happens in the cosmos. There is a complete disconnect there, and we talked about this a little bit on the Jarenism Lounge show on Friday. If you want to hear that discussion, by all means, go over to Jaren's channel at Jarenism and take a listen to that. But I wanted to elaborate on that quite a bit today. Other things we're going to be covering, of course, the latest news about the Mad Mike alleged death, and there seems to be some question about that, to say the least. So we are going to kind of delve into that and take a look at it. And we have several other nifty little things that we're going to be talking about. So hopefully everybody will enjoy today's show. But before we get to that, we have another full panel with us today, and we'll go ahead and get them introduced. So first up, as always, is Jaren from Jarenism. How are you doing today, buddy?
Doing good, Bob. Yourself?
Doing good, doing good. It's snowing again in Denver today. Can you believe it?
Wow, it was just nice 2 days ago.
I know. Well,
beautiful. Guess it changes like that. So, no, things are nice here in California, a little on the cool side, but no complaints.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, it's Colorado. If you don't like the weather, just wait a minute. That's pretty much our motto. So, all right. So next up, we have Iru Landucci from the Land Down Under on his mobile device. And hopefully, Iru, are you with us? Or are you participating in the conference? There you are.
Exactly. We are, right now, we have 2 days of Flat Earth conference here in Argentina. So I am using my computer and my YouTube channel to transmit that. So I'm going to be a little bit on Globebuster show and the other part in the Flat Earth conference here. So hello, everyone, and thank you for having me on.
Awesome. Yeah, well, I definitely want to talk to you a little bit about what's going on with that here in a bit. So stay tuned, guys, for Ear's report on that. Next up, we have our newest Globebuster, Austin Witsit from Witsit Gets It. How are you doing today, Austin?
Hey, I'm doing good, man. Happy to be here. How you doing?
Doing really well. Another information-packed show we have for everybody today. So, and you and I are going to be talking about, I think you and I are going to be elaborating on this whole gravitational, you know, debacle.
Cool. Yeah, that's what it is. So I'm definitely down.
All right. Sounds good. All right. And next up, we have the doctor who is in, Rodrigo Ferrar Nunez. How are you doing today, Rodrigo?
Hello, Bob. How's it going? How's it going, everyone? Doing fine. Yeah, doing good. Getting ready for tonight's theme. Actually, by chance, I've been reading on, you know, the structure of scientific revolutions, which is a book by Thomas Kuhn, which is classic of social science, critiquing the paradigms of science and how they change. And I found something on gravity that fits exactly, and it's something I would like to talk about anyway, and it's going to add, I think, hopefully to the discussion. So I'm really curious to hear what's going to happen. Thank you for having me, Bob. Yeah.
Okay, beautiful. I'm glad you're gonna have some material to contribute to this, because some of the things I found about it this week are amazing. Of course, it's nothing that I hadn't thought of before, but I actually went in and dug into mainstream sources to kind of verify, you know, what I'm going to talk about. So that ought to be good. And also this week, we have two guest panelists with us. First, they're both, they both have been here before. And the first one, you know, which is the UAP channel. How are you doing today, UAP?
Great. Glad to be here. How you doing, Bob?
Doing good. Doing good. All right. Cool. And, you know, I have to apologize for my bad manners because usually it's ladies first. So I'm so sorry about that. But we also have with us Karen B. From the Karen B. channel. How you doing today, Karen?
I'm doing very well. Thank you for having me.
Well, we're very glad to have you here. And I got to tell you, I love the show you did. I believe it was This Morning with Brian? Is that when you guys streamed that?
Yes, we did do a stream this morning.
Okay. All right. Yeah, we'll definitely be talking about that here very shortly. But welcome to the show. Glad to have you back. And let's get started. So, all right, guys. So the first thing I want to talk about, let me get my tabs organized here. That is not what I wanted. Let me jump over these. I got these a little bit discombobulated. But the first thing I wanted to show was the Epsilon 3 launch that Iru sent us. And this is just something that it's another one of those things that is so obvious, but it's definitely worth a mention. So Iru, do you want a comment about what we're about to see here on this launch?
Well, that was presented in a Spanish YouTube channel. In fact, the guy is a friend of mine, and I didn't have the time to make deep research about you know, what kind of rocket that there is, because could be something, you know, some kind of test rocket or something like that. I know that the Japanese space agency, it's you know, I'm subscribed to the official, you know, the equivalent to NASA, and they are very active. It's like they are the agency behind all the asteroids and meteor, you know, and comet research in terms of what they present to the public. It's like, you know, it's like every agency out there has their own agenda to brainwash people. And like the Japanese is the one who are behind the asteroid, the comet, and things like that. And I don't know exactly what kind of rocket test is this, because I don't know if this is some kind of official rocket launch that they say that maybe reach, you know, the outer space or something like that. But in terms of comparison, you know, it's a nice thing to know, you know, to compare with the SpaceX rocket launches or, you know, NASA rocket launches and things like that. So I just share in the comment of a Skype chat group, you know, just for sharing with the people.
Okay, very good. Yeah, I looked at, and of course, to me, it's the same old story. It's a time lapse video of this rocket ship going up, and it goes up pretty much straight up, and then you get a stage separation like here, and it, you know, blasts off, gives a wonderful light show all the while it's going down. And you know, then there's apparently another stage separation, I'm guessing. I'm not exactly sure what's going on there.
I think it's a three stage rocket, so, but you know, it's getting out of view. It's like a missile. It's something like that. No, I don't think there is a special thing. But
I love how, you know, it gets outpaced by the jets in the same shot. It gets outpaced by two jets. I don't know if you noticed that.
Yeah, it totally does. It's like, and why are these jets even, you know, whatever this thing is really flying across the screen at easily double the speed. And so is this thing. And it almost looks like it's going to collide with it.
Perspective, but the airplane seems to be going straight, and it clearly is coming down.
Yeah, absolutely bizarre. Okay. Wow. I just looked up and noticed we have two super chats. One from I Am Lone Frog, who says, wish I could send more. Say flat, sends $100. Holy cow. Thank you so much for that, I Am Lone Frog. That's awesome. That's really, really appreciated. Thank you. Thank you so much. And then the second one we got was, again, from our friend Robert Zafaris, who has been a longtime Globebuster supporter, sends us a $50 super chat with no message. But Robert, thank you so much. You are a rock star, sir, and you've always been here for us. And we really appreciate you. All right. Cool. All right. So let's go on then. And let's see what else we have. This is another good one. And this one, Taboo Conspiracy released. And Ben, Ben is going to be taking a couple of weeks off. He has been so involved with making Flat Earth videos and doing shows and you know, all the stuff that he does. He kind of got into a position where he left all of his paperwork behind, and he kind of got buried under a mountain of paperwork. And he thinks he needs to get that done and maybe spend a little bit of time with his family. And we certainly understand that. So Ben is going to take a week or two off, and you know, happy relaxation, Ben, on that, and enjoy your family and enjoy your time off. We will see you when you come back, sir. But in the meantime, we still have Ben's wonderful videos with us today, and I want to go ahead and play this one because this is a beauty. well, you know what? I'm just going to let him talk about it because nobody does it better than Taboo. Here we go. Oops. Do we have? Oh, sorry.
To the alleged vacuum.
My bad. Let's back up. I had the site.
Just
muted.
A quick video today. Of course, pointing out fake ISS videos is rather superfluous, since we already know for a fact that a pressurized atmosphere could never, ever exist adjacent to the alleged vacuum of space without a barrier, and the ISS would just explode like the soda can. A pressurized atmosphere and the vacuum of space are mutually exclusive. It's a matter of physics, and not one NASA fanboy can explain it without resorting to some cartoonish globe wizardry that cannot be practically demonstrated in any manner.
Ah, yeah. Well, whenever you notice something like that, a wizard did it.
But pointing out obvious NASA fakery is sometimes pretty entertaining. This little video clip can be found here. And it is supposedly footage of the ISS taken from the Soyuz spaceship. But just look at it. It's a ridiculous model. I mean, how weak-minded do you have to be to believe that this is anything but a model? I truly don't understand the gullibility of the masses and the mental disorder that they suffer from. This is just stupid. If you believe this is real, you are suffering from a mental disorder called space credulity. We do have a cure for it, but it requires you to actually open your eyes. Please wake up and help us end the space insanity that is destroying humanity.
It's only a model.
From a mental disorder.
Yeah, the space shuttle is more clean than the Curiosity on Mars. It's amazing clean. There are no kind of cluster, motion, dust or debris or, you know, chunk. It's super clear, man.
It looks like a toy.
It is a toy.
I was gonna say. Yeah.
The proportion, you know, the depth in the camera, field of view. I mean, it's... And I have a lot of models here in my computer because they use real scale, you know, models of the ISS. They presented in the conference, things like that, but very detailed, not just like a toy model, very detailed model of the ISS.
So you're saying the 3D ones nowadays are way better than this?
No, it's better. Not in this case, but we still have better, better computer graphic when you use miniature and models, because the light, it's very difficult to fake the same kind of the behavior of the nature light. versus the CGI light. So mm-hmm. in a lot of movies, they use miniature and models, even in our days when right. we have super, you know, computer graphics technology. But if you can do it with models and lighting with real life light, it's much better than the CGI. Star Wars use a lot of that. Get a digital too. I mean, but this is not the case. Okay, this is not the best example to talk about faking reality with miniature.
Yeah, this is so bad. I mean, it is so obvious that it is a model, and I cannot believe, honestly, anybody with any integrity or honesty whatsoever, any of the ballers could possibly look at this and say, no, that's absolutely real. It is so clear, so patently clear that this is a model. I mean, all of it is for sure, but you look at the way that the space shuttle, yeah. I mean, that is a model. That is just a pathetic job.
Somebody bumped the solar panels because they're not all aligned the same way, you know, like you would think. Like, oh, no, we're getting too much energy. You know, do they turn it? I don't think so. Somebody just knocked into it is all.
The solar panel.
Terrible.
The solar panels too is ridiculous. And I really like to see some astronauts flying around it.
Yeah.
And they have no choice, really, Bob. I mean, they have no choice but you. Tell everybody. I mean, imagine if they ever admitted that anything was fake, then it's very easy to take the next step, which is it's all faked, which is a step that many of us have taken numerous times. That's why any glober just has to look at it and say, nope, I have to believe this. I have to believe my religion is true.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It's very, very sad because this is so obvious. I mean, what can you say? It's just bad. So anyway, great job with, I think he said Mike Bull pointed this out, or maybe that was the other thing, the vacuum, but, you know, whoever found this, on the European Space Agency page, great spot, even though it really doesn't take much to spot how phony this is, but, wow. So amazing.
As far as the pressurized can, you know, I could see people seeing that and saying, oh, well, that's much thinner than the ISS. That's why the can explodes. But then you have to remember that the LEM, the lunar lander, was supposedly as thick as a piece of tinfoil. So, yeah. So you can't go there either.
Yeah. Sure.
And the can has a certain shape because of the pressure differential that oftentimes the spaceships that we're supposed to believe in don't have, with the flat sides and the sharp angles. Imagine having a pressurized soda can that is like a perfect cube. It would be really hard to do, but that's what they're claiming to do in a more extreme situation.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we've talked about that several times. I mean, the Sandusky vacuum facility in Ohio, literally, they talk about the reason that they need 8-foot steel and concrete thick walls is so that it literally does not draw the atmosphere through them. And
Sandusky. I'm not too far from there, so I can tell you. It's Sandusky, Ohio.
Sandusky, yeah. Okay, sorry.
Yep.
But regardless, I mean, so they have to have 8-foot thick steel and concrete walls to stop the atmosphere to be, you know, from being drawn through it. And this is in their own words, ladies and gentlemen, this, and NASA themselves said this. So how can we have the space shuttle pressurized at 14.7 PSI, the stated pressurization of the ISS, against a 10 to the negative 17th torr with a very, very thin, barely thicker than a pop can, what we just saw explode, you know, and not exploding into the, you know, nothingness of space. There's just no way. The Sandusky is nowhere near the 10 to the negative 17th torr. In fact, it's maybe halfway there at best. Wouldn't you say, UAP?
Well, I can't verify or vouch for it having pulled a vacuum at all. In my experience, it's such of a large chamber. I would be surprised if it could pull even as hard of a vacuum as you would pull in a much smaller chamber and like a home setup. It's absolutely huge. The one near Sandusky with the huge chamber that Cryan Box was in, Brian Cox, where they dropped the feather. That was used, a lot of people may be familiar with it and not know it. It was used to film the movie Avengers, the one in 2012. And the scene where they're kind of underground and they're messing around with the Tesseract, it was used for that. They find other uses for it because I don't know that it's actually used what its purpose, used for alleged what its purpose states. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. We had a comment in the chat that's... Oh, go ahead, Iru.
No, I mean, not just the spaceship itself, but also the astronaut suit, for example. I mean... Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a huge one for me. I can't get over it. How they're flexible. How could it be flexible? Yeah. If you've ever handled like a vacuum pack of coffee, that would be flexible. Right. Except it's a vacuum, so you do it in reverse. The space suit, whatever material it is going to be that hard. Is it going to push out in all directions? Basically look like the Stay Puft Marshmallow guy and be like rock hard, and that's what they're supposed to be using to move around. I just don't buy it. It's a joke to me. It's like baggy jeans, you know, like that's what in the moon footage, it looks like just baggy clothes that they're wearing, honestly.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. There's no, it should be stiff as a board. We had a comment in the chat that says NASA says the concrete is for radiation shielding due to nuclear experiments. Well, I have never seen NASA state that. And in fact, like I said, right on the homepage of the vacuum facility itself, they say that the steel and concrete is to keep from drawing the atmosphere through. Not only that, if NASA was using it for radiation shielding, you would think that they would use lead, not concrete, right? So to me, you know, I don't know where you read that, but to me, that makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. And I have never seen any radioactive experiments done in the vacuum at that facility. But, you know, I don't see everything, so maybe I missed it.
Yeah, this is just, again, one of those examples of science that we know works on the Earth and does not apply in space, like temperatures and now pressure, of course. I think Nathan mentioned last week that, you know, it's hot, but it's not hot when they go there. And there's, you know, there's this problem with pressure, but no problem that you can just go with a tent.
Yeah. Oh, one thing I wanted to mention, too, while we're talking about this, you know that experiment I've seen it. You guys have covered it before several times with the vacuum. It's supposed to be the one time that NASA tested a suit, and the guy, the seal broke on the suit, and he fell back. I was thinking about it. Yeah, I was thinking about it, and he falls back. But I watched it again. He's moving around. I don't think. Based on two reasons, the size of that chamber and the fact that his suit doesn't expand outward, I don't think he was under much of a vacuum at all. Well, think that test may not have been an actual real test.
I would agree with vacuum. That. But also UAP, you know, playing devil's advocate, they did say that there was a leak in the suit, right, which was not protecting him and keeping him pressurized, because he said the last thing that he remembered before he passed out was the saliva on his tongue was starting to boil. So, but you're right. There should have been visible signs of pressurization in that suit. And the amazing thing about it is you would have thought that the techs observing that would have known that. But
yeah,
you know,
well, just... yeah, that and then the fact too that it would have been almost impossible to recover, because if they're pulling a vacuum and they get far enough along with that, you have to repressurize over time. Yeah, a lot of different things would have happened that didn't seem to happen, and it seemed like the clip ends and. It's like, well, what happened next? You know, like when did he start breathing again, or how does it work? You know, your lungs would be pressed together. And it's like a wet bag. You know, if you push all the air out of it, it's not that easy to get air back into it. You know, there's a lot of stuff that would have had to have happened that we don't see. And the whole thing seems like a made up thing to explain why they don't do the testing. It's like an act.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, I'm looking for something here real quick, and maybe if I can't find it, but there was, I posted a, in the chat, guys, I think yesterday or something. Oh, maybe I should just look in our chat for it. But the Russian cosmonaut that was saying that they never went to space.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I saw that.
Where is that? I wanted to show that one next. Where'd it go? Good grief. So we'll show that one. But I'll tell you what, let me actually just play a different video until I find it. We'll get to Mad Mike here in a minute. But in the meantime, let's look at NASA's newest propaganda piece where they are going to be hiring new astronauts. And so we're going to get a look at what it takes to become a new NASA astronaut. And you guys are just going to die over this. It's ridiculous. But let's give this a listen while I look for that other video. Here we go, guys.
You know, most of us are pretty normal people.
Being an astronaut requires kind of a variety of skills.
The three things that it takes to be an astronaut are technical skill, operational skills, and then just being fun and easy to be around.
I would say that the number one most important quality trait is humility.
You can't be in space and call the plumber to fix your toilet. You can't be in space and call an electrician to fix an electrical problem. If you were to boil it down to something simple, I would say we're all mechanics. It's just really, really hard to get to the work site.
It would probably not be great if you were scared of tight spaces.
Being an astronaut really takes somebody with an explorer's spirit who knows how to work together with others.
Being an astronaut absolutely requires collaboration and being a good team player.
Honestly, it's a lot like being a good kindergartner. You just have to get along well with others. If you spill your glue, don't spill your glue again. Just kind of learn from your mistake.
There are many of you out there that we would love to be a part of this team.
Oh my! Is that
so?
Is that
you signing up? Who's signing up?
Yeah, who's gonna sign up? It's funny. I think Tell Me What You Love did a piece on this and made fun of it, but it was just unbelievable. This is so bad, and you can just hear all the NASA fanboys salivating over this, and you know, just I want to be a spaceman. I want to be an astronaut. And wow, it's just unbelievable, but it's part of the propaganda machine. And, you know, that's the way it goes. Okay, so thank you, Rodrigo, for pulling that up for me. Here is the video, and I don't think that other video even deserves any more attention. It was that ridiculous. But
what a joke. They have more actors now, and it's celebrating them. There was another, if you saw the induction of the new astronaut class as well, with Bridenstine and everyone there. That was some weeks ago that they're just pushing it, right? They have a bunch of money. No, they have even more money apparently somehow.
It just makes you think though, they have to be pretty comfortable with to do that, right? They're going out on like the aggressive with all of the space propaganda, even recruiting and all. I mean, that you would think that, well, we know they have something in their pockets. It's intel agencies where they think they've got it down pat well enough they can fake a lot, you would think, right?
You would think, yeah, absolutely. It's lunacy. Well,
they didn't commit to it, though, did they, Austin? Like, I don't know that they committed to it. They just said they planned or hoped or scheduled, you know. But they always push it out. I think they'll push it out again. I don't know.
Yeah, touche. I think it just kind of like keeps the people like believing the nonsense and dragging them along. But it just seems like they're getting so blatant. It could just be damage control because people are finding out, of course, we were lied to about the Earth. Yeah.
Of course. They need more propaganda and faster and more lies and more storylines all at the same time, because that keeps people thinking, how could possibly they be faking this? Because that's one of the big questions. Like, why would they do it? And how could they hide it from all the other agencies? Like, they keep saying the same thing, but they don't know it's a franchise. But yeah, there you have it. I mean, as long as people keep seeing this stuff, I think that's probably what they thinking. The repetition is important.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so next up, a hat tip to Mark W. for the super chat. No comment with it, but thank you very much, Mark W., for that. And also hat tip to That Flat Fellow. Thank you very much, That Flat Fellow, who is our activist in North Carolina. And I'm glad he finally got his 1,000 subscribers. We got him up to that a few weeks ago. He's going out and doing some really great street activism. He says, keep up the great work and research. We all appreciate your hard work. Thank you very much, That Flat Fellow. We appreciate it. And cheers to you. Okay, so next up, this gentleman, Igor Volk, who apparently died not that long ago, and it's probably why this video hasn't really surfaced up until recently. He said he died on 3 January 2017. Igor Volk was a cosmonaut, and he was selected as a cosmonaut on 12 July 1977 and flew as a research cosmonaut on Soyuz T-12, the seventh expedition to Salyut 7. Blah, blah, blah. Basically, just validating who he is and what he allegedly did. And in this video, and I'm not exactly sure what this was, what show it is, but obviously something, I guess, in the Soviet Union or something. I'm not going to play the sound because it's all in Russian, but you can read down here in the translated closed captioning exactly what he was saying. After all, you're a hero of the Soviet Union, and we can trust you. And then the next thing that he says is, look. Keep going. The code of honor prevents the cosmonauts from talking about what happens in space. They just don't know anything about that. We haven't been to space. If someone claims that we have been, it's not true. It is not the truth. This is on which I am the viewers of. But anyway, so there you have it. We have a cosmonaut admitting on apparently some sort of national TV that they didn't go to space. So what do you guys think about that?
I think he accidentally said code of honor and he meant to say Masonic pledge.
Yeah, right.
It's not the first one, right? There was a Polish one before?
Yes.
Recently as well?
Yes, a Polish astronaut that said that the Earth was flat. So, you know, these
guys... I
never
saw that. That's interesting. Because people always mentioned, why don't they ever say that? But they have.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm sorry, Jern, what did you say?
Oh, that was me. I said Ben put that video up of the Polish astronaut saying that the Earth was flat.
Yeah, okay. Right.
Yeah, thanks.
And there were people in the comments saying that the translation was correct because, you know, a lot of people were saying, how do you know that's what he's really saying? But there were actual Polish people saying, no, that's what he's saying.
Yep. And then
why
as far
is this
as
Russian. So the dude's so cool about it. Sorry.
And you said this guy's dead now?
Yeah, he died a couple of years ago, and it's only recently that this video has surfaced.
Certainly interesting that he says the code of honor, because it's what we've all talked about, that if this is part of some sort of honor system or you've got some seal that you can't break, then it just makes a lot of sense that astronauts are. And then when you look at these recruitments and the 1 out of 4,000 and that you find that one person that's willing to take the oath, that understands that what we're trying to do is inspire children. We're trying to get them to be better, want them to reach for the stars. If we convince children that this is all that we have, then they won't try and be better people. They won't try and reach for the stars. They won't try and do better. But by giving these aspirations of Mars and the moon and we're going to travel there, then it just inspires people to go out and invent things. And it's so beautiful.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, I don't speak Russian, but I'm sure we have viewers out there that do. This will be in the show notes, but this is on Google Auto Translate. So, hey, if we can't trust Google, who can we trust, right? But yeah, so this is Google Auto Translating this, and you know, the machine shouldn't have any bias towards what's being said. But again, there is audio to it. I just don't speak Russian, so I don't see a lot of worth in playing it, but it will be in the show notes for those who would like to take a listen to it. Perhaps you know a little Russian and you can verify this. But I have no reason to doubt it, honestly. Just amazing. So
it makes sense that they would be coming out at some point and saying something to free their consciousness in some way. You know, they have nothing to lose. At some point, they're like, you know, who cares? I'm going to say the truth. Live with it for so long, you know. It's like a burden.
Yeah, I think they do it in their own way the best they can. A lot of them, you know, Neil Armstrong, we know, and John Glenn did it in an episode of Frasier, the TV show, where he's playing himself in the show and then goes off talking about what's really going on. And the way he did it, it's kind of like as if it could be aliens, but then if you look at it and interpret it another way, it could be everything that we know or suspect. And that's kind of like a mea culpa that they do. It's a veiled mea culpa, but a mea culpa nonetheless in some form.
Yeah, I agree. So anyway, it's a mad, 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 mad world. And, you know, whether you are a religious person or not, it seems like a lot of interesting things are coming true that were either biblically prophesized or prophesized through other means. Of course, there's a lot of different opinions on what prophecy can mean, but it does seem that a lot of things are being exposed. There's no doubt about that. Now, whether or not that's prophecy or a planned agenda, I know I certainly have my opinion on it, and I'm sure many people do as well. But it's just interesting that it is indeed coming to pass. No matter what the mechanism of it is. So just super interesting stuff. So, okay, so moving on. This is another very hotly talked about item. This just happened just yesterday on 2/22/2020. Interesting numerology behind that. But TMZ, which appears to be the only source that is reporting this, unless somebody else has been coming out with it and not citing TMZ, but everybody that I've seen so far has cited this TMZ article, that Daredevil Mike Hughes dead at 64 in a fatal rocket crash landing. Well, there's a lot to say about this, and I guess, you know, I'll take the lead and say what I think, you know, because I'm used to getting crap for saying stuff. But the first thing I want to say is that Mad Mike was not a flat earther, all right? This was something that he made very clear at the Denver conference, and the only reason he was even doing this, A, was because he was being paid to put the promotional message Flat Earth on the side by the Infinite Troll Society. And, you know, he basically said it had absolutely nothing to do with Flat Earth. And the only reason that he was there was to try and get sponsors for him to go out and carry out these stunts. He may be dead. He may not be dead. Let's just say there's a lot of interesting and suspicious activity that surrounds this. And I will say that I don't really think that he was much of a friend to Flat Earth, and he certainly wasn't a flat earther. He was promoted by, you know, like I said, the Infinite Troll Society, who, you know, their founder, Jacob Vigil, has stated several times that he is not a flat earther. He's only infiltrated it to be able to sell books. This is on record that he has stated this. And so it doesn't surprise me at all that he would be somebody that backs this guy. Mad Mike was highly, highly critical of many of the figures in Flat Earth. He even went so far as to buy corporate versions of people's names, like Patricia Steer and Mark Sargent, to be able to hold against them or collect any government dues that were against him. So, you know, I met the guy. He seemed you know, okay in person, but, you know, he was very candid about the harm that he wanted to bring on several of the flat earthers. And he was also very candid about the fact that he was not a flat earther. And this is my experience. I know I am not the only person that believes this. We have had several other people that have done, you know, videos on this. Brian Stavely and Karen did this morning. They are essentially saying the same thing. Wildly enough, Mr. Thrive and Survive is saying the exact same thing. We will cover that. Jamie from A Plain Truth is saying the very same thing. In other words, you know, condolences to his family if this is true. But, you know, the fact that this is linked with Flat Earth and the fact that what the mainstream has done to this, you know, with this guy and basically trying to ridicule Flat Earthers, I think was something that was planned all along. And this just makes this whole thing highly suspicious to me. So that's my take on it. And what does everybody else think?
Well, I think it's kind of a combination of planned and inevitable. I mean, this is the direction it's going to go. If you keep launching yourself in a homemade rocket, trying to get 1,000 feet high, trying to get 3,000 feet high, something is bound to go wrong. So it's pretty sad when you look at all these places that kind of contacted him, whether it's the Science Channel, whether it's, I don't know, whoever's funding this. It can't be cheap. So who's funding all this? I have a feeling it's some of these channels that are out there that funded him doing this, like Science Channel or whoever else. I don't know who's funding this, but he had to keep creating this rocket. He had to keep heading out there and doing this. And I just think eventually the inevitable is going to happen. But again, that's if it is true. And if it is true, condolences to his family and hope you rest in peace. But, you know, my warning would be to everyone else, I don't think that launching yourself in a rocket is the way to go here. And you're right, Bob. I mean, I read a few articles. There's a guy named Schuster who's like his PR agent. And I'm reading from right here in an article from the Los Angeles Times that says Schuster, who did not attend Saturday's launch, said the Flat Earth argument helped drum up publicity and sponsors for Hughes, who made his rockets at home in Apple Valley. And it quotes him as saying, "I don't think he believed it," Schuster said. "He did have some governmental conspiracy theories, but don't confuse that with the Flat Earth thing. That was a PR stunt that we dreamed up," end quote. So, I mean, it's his own publicist telling you right there that this was a PR stunt. And again, I've texted Mike back and forth before, met him, like you said, Bob, in Denver. He seemed like a decent guy to me in person, but then again, he also had some sinister ideas about taking people's names and identities and trying to claim the corporate fiction of their name. Just a bunch of nonsense that went with it, and it just seems like this guy's been surrounded by nonsense from day one to talk about something he didn't believe in. But again, by putting Research Flat Earth on his rocket, he made some money and was able to fund it. If it's true, hey, sorry, and you know, but heed the warning to everybody else: don't put yourself in a rocket to get 1,000 feet. You're not going to prove whether the Earth is flat that way. There's a lot more.
Yeah, of course. Nobody who's a flat earther or that questions the ball would ever get on a rocket, because one of the points we make is that if you accelerate that fast, you're obviously going to die. It's probably not the best way to go up anyway to see anything. It's a terrible mode of transportation is what it is. But also some people will probably point out that MM from Mad Mike also points to, you know,
33.
Yep.
Also, yeah. Do have to say, just like on the surface, I mean, this guy keeps doing this over and over and having issues that are putting his life into danger, and then he keeps doing it. And conveniently enough, this is the flat earther that – the quote-unquote flat earther that keeps getting put every time he's doing something. He's put on the mainstream. If you type this in – if you type something in YouTube, he'll come up, right. And it just ends like this. I mean, it is quite convenient. You know,
I totally agree with Austin. That's kind of what I'm saying, is that it just seemed like they kept pushing him to do this
red flag there.
Yeah, I mean, as if it would prove anything. In fact, the only people out there saying this will never prove anything, and even he said it, right? I mean, if you watched his documentary on, I don't remember whether it's on Amazon or
Amazon. It was on Amazon.
Yeah, so when you watch that documentary, I mean, he's saying that, no, I'm not doing this to say that the Earth is flat. Yet in all the articles that talk about him, it's constantly flat earther, and you kept getting pushed. And like Austin said, I mean, if you keep doing this, eventually you're going to miss some step, whether it's attaching your parachute or even in the documentary, his parachutes always had holes in them. It's like this was set up to fail from the very beginning. And this guy had a death wish. That's I mean, even in this article here, it says that everybody knew that Mike would never live to be, trying to find the exact quote. We all, right here. This guy, this is Schuster again. This is his PR agent. He said, this guy knew he wasn't going to live until he was 80. I spent a lot of hours with him. He knew it, Schuster added. He had something in him that compelled himself to push himself further each time. Well, somebody caught wind of that. Somebody knew that. What better way to place a flat earth label on this guy, keep pushing him until his parachute didn't open?
Yeah,
exactly. And I think the way that would make it work real well is if it is authentic, in the sense this dude's really just out here doing some crazy stuff, but you co-opt the situation to put flat earth there to make it look out there.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what really was going out, and he really was doing this. Now, I'm not saying this particular time. I haven't seen any video yet of him getting in the rocket. Like in the last launches, we have all the video of him getting in, strapping in. Now, all the video I've been able to see. Now, I say that because tomorrow or the next day or a week from now or a month from now, maybe the footage will come out. Obviously, the Science Channel was there. The Science Channel was the one doing the documentary on him. So they have to have footage of it. So we will eventually see it, but you can just see all over flat earth or dies in rocket crash. You know, it's all about this placing this flat earth label on him that, again, even his PR agent says that was just a PR stunt. So it just seems awful. Like you said, Austin, it just seems to be right up the alley that they're looking for. Here's the guy that they can label as a flat earther, why he makes it into the mainstream news, front page articles every time, and then dies. Yeah.
That's the problem. That's the big red flag for me, the fact that he's always somehow in the news, in the whole world, not just in the United States, because people from Brazil are sending me stuff about him when he first showed up to clown the conference. Right? There's been several of these trolls. Like, you can actually identify it as a, you know, first, second, third generation trolls, and then insider trolls, infiltrators, and so on. It's a whole cast of characters.
The other thing I'm saying too, I kept saying documentary. It looks like, from what I can read in these articles, that the Science Channel was doing a TV series, a TV show. So I keep saying documentary. It may have actually been
Homemade Astronauts, I believe it was called.
So I don't know. They must have footage of him getting in that rocket. And but if anybody's seen the video, I don't know.
It's weird. Nobody, you know, imagine if it's somebody I know, even if it wasn't somebody I knew, but I was there live, and if I saw that parachute right at the beginning, the parachute just falls off, I would already be saying, you know, screaming or something. Nobody's saying anything. Nobody's running towards it. I thought it was very suspicious.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and in my opinion, honestly, knowing that he was not a flat earther, and, you know, knowing the people that were promoting him. And by the way, that's another thing I found highly suspicious is, you know, he was highly, you know, tied to the Infinite Troll Society, who... You know, basically, they auto-hoax everything, especially anything that comes out of TMZ. And I kind of caught one of their broadcasts last night or this morning, I can't remember. And they're, you know, they're just accepting it, you know, sight unseen, which to me, again, if, for somebody that auto-hoaxes literally everything, for them to just accept this and then start selling T-shirts, by the way, if I got that right, Karen.
Exactly, Bob. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, the guy unquestionably is going to be given a Darwin Award, right? And the thing is that look at these stories. I mean, it has increased exponentially since the first time I checked that this morning. And, you know, every single one of them, flat earther, idiot, flat earther, you know, all of this is to discredit us. And, you know, that's what it was from the very beginning, is to bring ridicule on flat earth. And, you know, congratulations, you know, he did it quite well. And like I said, he was not a flat earther, and he is being attributed to somebody that was. And I think that this is just another psyop. And, you know, like you said, Rodrigo, when you look at the video, nobody goes to his aid. Nobody seems to be surprised. The guy in the foreground of the original video, there's a guy that's just sitting there looking around on the ground for something when this rocket comes down and plummets into the ground. And it's like, no big deal. You know, it didn't even matter. So it's like, you look at that and it's like, what is wrong with these people, right? Why didn't anybody run out there to his, and of course the response to that is as well, obviously he was dead already. And it's like, well, you don't know that, you know, I mean, they should have at least tried to run out and render help, but no, it's really suspicious.
Yeah. Yeah, compare it with Ayrton Senna, you know, the Formula One racer from Brazil who died in the track. But, you know, everybody's seen the guy driving and then he hits a wall. you know, and there's immediate rush, you know, or Niki Lauda, the guy that burned in the car, you know, there was an immediate rush to help the people because they're in there, you know, the, it's very different. You can even compare it to some other situations, the real situations with the, yeah, fake stuff.
Yeah. So Karen, you and Brian did a show on that this morning. And so, I mean, what do you, give us your take, you know, tell us some of the experiences that you had.
Well, I mean, well, first of all, yeah, Brian and I started messaging each other about it this morning. He doesn't buy it, you know, because it does look very suspicious. It's like you guys said, I mean, there's no video of him getting in the rocket. There's no other video of it at all. There's just this. Every other news story references the TMZ news story as the source for their story. And in proper journalism, you are supposed to get your story verified from two separate independent sources before you run it as true. Clearly that never happens anymore in any sort of journalism, but all of these, I mean, read the stories. They all reference the TMZ article, and the story, the video was released so quickly after it happened. I mean, just maybe like an hour, less than a couple of hours after it happened. It's already, everybody's showing video of him dying. It just is very, very suspicious. And like you said, people are already making t-shirts about it. It's crazy.
Yeah. And this whole thing is not meant to trash Mad Mike. I mean, obviously those of us that dealt with him did not think he had very high morals, and, you know, his disdain towards the flat earth community was amazing. I mean, he's on record and of saying a lot of that stuff. To me personally, you know, I could not believe some of the stuff he was saying about it. So, no, he was not a flat earther. It absolutely was not. Anybody that tells you he was is telling you stories, because there's footage of him admitting it straight up, just like there's footage of Infinite Troll Society saying, well, I'm only doing this flat earth thing because, you know, it sells books. And then he pulled that down conveniently, by the way. But, you know, like I said, some of the top names in Flat Earth are also saying the very same thing. Mr. Thrive and Survive, of all people, said this was absolutely a scam from the get-go. And it, the whole psyop, if you will, was to tie Mad Mike to the Flat Earth when he was not a Flat Earther, and ridicule and humiliate us. I mean, for crying out loud, look at how many stories there are. This, you know, Flat Earth has not seen this kind of coverage since 3 years ago, right? And all of a sudden, we get a guy that's essentially going for a Darwin Award, and it's everywhere. Only,
yeah,
because,
why is he so important? Flat Earth, that's the
spreading
thing.
Like wildfire.
I was going to say, Flat Earth hasn't seen this kind of press since Mad Mike.
Right.
To be honest.
So yeah, I mean, and like I said, if he in fact, you know, died doing what he loved, well, more power to him. But the media debacle that's tying him to flat earthers is just, it's just a psyop. It really is. And I think it's reprehensible. You know, but like I said, in meeting the guy, you know, there's a side of him that's, you know, he's kind of a nice guy, you know, when he wasn't trashing, you know, other flat earthers and trying to usurp them on their corporate identities. You know, and he was a human being, and, you know, for that, all I can say is rest in peace, Mike. But, I'm not entirely convinced that he's not in the same boat as Epstein, frankly, you know, but whatever.
I will say, it sets up that perfect paradigm. Like, I saw a meme earlier, and it's like posted to one of the flat earth groups, and it says, you know, don't learn your laws of physics from memes and YouTubes, like going at the flat earthers, you know, and at the picture of him. And I'm just like, dude, it's just so, it could just really happen, but it's just, that's why it's being pushed, is because it's so perfect to smear, you know?
But that's also, you know, it's so sickly to smear somebody who just died, in terms of, you know, how that works, in terms of the moral of that. You put somebody out there, oh, look how stupid the guy, the way he died, you know, nobody cares. It's like this very cold kind of society. It, you know, of course, they play with people's feelings by faking deaths as well. So they play with that. But still, the people that come out making those kind of things, that coming after flat earthers, using this guy as an example, you know, it's pathetic.
I'm not,
I agree.
I'm gonna take the position that I don't think it makes any sense to fake the death. Why? Because you could easily have killed him in that dumb rock.
No problem. Yeah, that's right. I know. I totally agree.
It's ridiculously simple. I mean,
he was asking for it, right?
Think how many things would have had to go wrong. There's got to be some sort of altimeter deployment system for the backup parachute. That didn't happen. There's got to be an emergency oh shit handle. That didn't happen. They say he was knocked out. Nobody will ever know that. There obviously was no contact with him. It just seems to me that if you kept allowing this guy to launch himself into the sky for no reason, I mean, really, there's no reason other than this is what this guy loved. He was a thrill seeker. There's people out there like that. I mean, the guy used to jump limousines, would, you know, he loved to put himself in a rocket and launch himself. So he had to know this eventually was going to be his demise. Turns out that it's his demise. Do I think they would fake this? I don't think there's a reason to. I think all you have to do is keep propping him up every time he goes out and has a launch. Just keep telling everybody, Flat Earther is going to launch himself. Flat Earther is going to launch himself. Knowing that the best thing that would ever happen is he would go 2,000 feet and a parachute would come out and he'd land. And they would say, Flat Earther launches himself in another rocket with, you know, and does nothing, proves nothing. So you just keep doing that until the inevitable happens. What's the inevitable? That somebody forgets some little thing. There's like three people helping him out of it. That's right. It's just, there's like no team. There's nobody there to double check things. There's no, there are backup systems. So this was going to happen. And it happened. I mean, it's just like predicting that the sun would rise tomorrow. You could predict Mike Hughes would die in a rocket crash. So do we really need to fake that? I'm not sure. I think that it eventually was bound to happen, whether it was this year, next year, or the year after. If you keep launching a homemade rocket once a year, twice a year, and this is the guy behind the whole system, it's going to fail.
Yeah, and it makes perfect sense. I
kind of disagree with you on that a little bit, Jaren, because I think there is a motive for him to fake it, because clearly his motive is to get money for his rockets, right? That's what his motive has always been, or money or publicity for his rockets. This is a perfect stunt to get a bunch of attention on him for quote unquote supposedly dying in a stunt, right? And getting himself in the news.
If you're the powers that be, and like you said, okay, he wants money. Is it easier to give him the money he wants and then have him go hide out, or is it easy to let him die?
Well, I don't know that the control of this narrative goes that high. You know, I don't know.
Maybe not. Maybe that's true. Maybe you're right. I'm not saying that there's no chance that this is fake, because you're right. Anybody, I mean, all you'd have to offer.
And
is
he could really be dead. I could be totally wrong.
Right.
I mean, and I admit that. It could be legit. It could be.
Yeah, we certainly haven't seen enough to determine whether or not it's real.
And this is the kind of guy you could probably offer $100,000 and say, hey, we'll give you $100,000. You can move to France. And maybe he does that. I don't know. But to me, it just seems a lot easier rather than give the guy $100,000 and make him move to France where he's a liability. You just keep having him do what he loves doing, launching himself in that rocket, and the inevitable will eventually happen, and it happens.
Yeah. But yeah, again, like I was going to say about motorcycle people, you know, they understand that it is dangerous what they're doing. They understand that it may happen, that they may just die very quickly out of nowhere. You know, I know about this because in my studies I ran across people, you know, there's a funeral a friend of mine told me about from bikers in a bikers rally that was a, you know, 19-year-old who died. And they told the people in the funeral to play Highway to Hell from AC/DC and they pumped it up high in the funeral, because that the idea is that they understand that, you know, what they're doing is dangerous and, you know, someone may go. So even with that, imagine with the rocket that, you know, of course.
It's a great story just for all the reasons too. Like, nobody should try and do this stuff on their own. Nobody should try and, you know, and I technically agree with that if you're talking on such a small scale. Now, if we could go out and launch rockets, sounding rockets, things like that, I don't certainly think we need to put people in them. But
it's so crazy to put people in rockets. That's the whole point from the beginning.
That's the point, right? So, I mean, it's like, this is just a good story for them to say, oh, see, only NASA can do this so great. This guy tries it, he dies. NASA's fantastic because they can put people in these rockets and launch them at Mach 25 and they do just fine. So it's a great storyline. My only opinion on it, like I said, the only way I differ from Karen is I just think that this was inevitable. It didn't need to happen today. So knowing that, there's no reason. I just think that they could have kept letting him launch himself and eventually this is going to happen. He almost died last time. I mean, think about it. And he almost died the time before. Every time he did it, he never like walked away from the thing like, hey, this went great. Everything.
That's right. He messed up, right? Every time he gets
yeah, he jacked himself up bad.
Right. They had to drag him out every single time. So anybody behind this would have said, hey, if this guy can't do this, eventually something's going to go wrong, especially when you have parachutes with holes in it. I mean,
right. But I will say that's kind of why it seems so sketchy to me. Like, I don't know much about this dude or whatever, but one of my friends just typed something about flat Earth and he comes up, you know, man launches himself in self-made rocket to prove flat Earth theory. And it's got like, you know, it's got like 2 million views and he gets seriously injured where we have the documentation of it. You get to see, just like you're saying, you should never even think about trying to explore for yourself or anything. And then they show you the most inefficient way to do it. So he got hurt a few times, looked like, wow, why would someone keep doing this? That's retarded. And right. Then it ended. Just the sequence of events of the popularity of the mainstream is a little red flag for me. Like, I would have to, I guess, retain my assessment until maybe we see more footage or something. I don't know. It just seems real weird.
Yeah, and I think that is the weirdest part about it. You'd think there'd be other video. For some reason, it seemed like every other time he launched, and maybe it's just because I'm remembering the documentary, but you could see him get in it. You could see the people doing checks, and then he gets out. They have to delay it a day. So all I've seen is the news report that, yep, yesterday he went out, and yesterday he killed himself. And it certainly looked like the launch.
Would you say, like, that in the documentary, you see him getting in, and you see him being propelled inside the thing and everything. It seems that he's actually doing it. You'd say.
I don't know. I haven't seen that. I mean, I'm just saying in the past, you could tell that he pretty much was in that rocket and got hurt.
In the past, I mean.
Now, again, the Science Channel supposedly is out there filming a TV show. So there's probably, you would think, a documentary coming out about the death. I don't know. Doesn't mean that it's true. I'm just saying that it seems to me like this was inevitable. I mean, if you go back to that picture that Bob showed of the rocket, if you look at that and think there's a guy who's a flat earther who keeps putting himself in there, what better story for the mainstream than to keep running with it, knowing that the inevitable result of this was never going to be him ending up in space. The inevitable result of this was never going to be him getting high enough that he could see curve or no curve. Everybody knows that. It just seems like the only person who didn't was Mike. All he kept doing was he'd launch himself 1,200 feet in the air, and then the next time say, now I'm going for 1,400 feet. Well, that's pretty – okay, great. What are you going to do with that? Now I'm going for 1,600 feet. Why? Well, what would you do? Now I'm going for 2,000 feet and eventually dies. I mean, it just seems like that was...
Yeah, the progression, natural progression of things. Could see it coming from a mile.
I would think so, yeah. It's not like I was... It'd
be much more efficient for him to just, you know, buy an airline ticket. At least that way he'd get 6-7 miles up in the sky, right?
That's how you know he's not trying to prove flat Earth. I mean, that alone tells you. I mean, anybody could have just talked to him. And that's why even in his documentary, he says this is not to prove flat Earth. That's something that the media has gone with. That's something.
Yeah, I mean, as if it hasn't been proven different ways that there's no ball, right? That you need this. Like, it just makes no sense.
I know. Well, and you know,
how high was he ever going to get? I mean, he's in a steam-powered rocket. I don't know how high he was ever going to get. I mean, he's never going to get it to a mile, I would think. And the inevitable result was going to be that that rocket was going to crash, especially if, think about last time he went, and let's say he only gets, I don't know, 1,300 feet and almost is paralyzed coming out of there. If you move it to 1,500
feet,
it seems inevitable to me that eventually this crash would happen. It shouldn't really be a shock.
Bigger fall, harder crash, you know, worse injuries.
What, this is from this recent time?
Yeah, this is it. Now watch this guy. Right after it happens, right? He's looking around. He's not even paying attention. The parachute rips off, as it's going up.
Has holes in it again. So it's a parachute that has holes in it from the start.
Yeah. Unbelievably bad job. You know, packing a parachute, honestly, is not that difficult. But I did it when I was 17 in the Air Force when I did a jump. Actually, I did several jumps. But, look at this guy.
Hold on, rewind that. To me, that guy puts his head down as, oh my God.
Yeah, that's what Rick was saying in a call earlier that we had.
Yeah, look at this. The thing hits, now watch him. He goes, oh shit.
However, you don't have to see his facial expression. Like, to me, that's something that could be easily faked.
Sure. It seems like, I thought he was like, he didn't care. That seems to me like you would, if you're filming that, you would put your head down like, oh my God, I cannot believe this just happened. But again, I wasn't out there.
I do have to agree with Jared in the sense that there's a lot of logic in thinking, well, if it is authentic, you know, like this dude's really out here doing that, that makes it so much more bulletproof to just run with it as it goes, you know, and really amp it up.
It's a great story. every time he does it. It's a great story for the media every time he does it, because it's flat earther launches himself 1,800 feet. Flat earther launches himself 2,200 feet, knowing that inevitable would be this. And as far as nobody running to him, that if there's a person inside that, believe me, right. there's no way you survived that.
Yeah, I thought there was no sound, you know, Jaren. That was the thing with the sound on, you know, nobody saying, oh, my God, or... this kind of thing I would expect. They don't see in the Challenger either.
Well, you can hear a little bit of screaming in the background. Here, let me play it with the sound, and we can hear that. I can hear what is going on here. Here we go. Yeah, it's weird. It almost sounds like they're cheering more than anything. It's just weird. I don't know what's going on with that. But again, we never saw anybody get into it. There doesn't seem to be any footage of him climbing into it. It's just odd, you know. But again, you know, like I said, the guy was a human being. But the flat earthers, I especially do not appreciate this guy being tied to the flat earth community when all the mainstream wants to do is give him a Darwin Award for being so dumb about doing this. And honestly, like Jaren said, you know, this was inevitable. It was bound to happen. And, you know, the bad thing about it was, is he went on and on and on saying he was Flat Earth's best hope for, you know, getting any credibility. And yet look what it's turned into. Yeah. Best hope, my butt. You know, it's really sad, but you know what? Condolences to his family and rest in peace, Mike.
RIP. I think that he, you know, based on what I've seen so far, I say he's dead. This is an inevitable thing. It's the equivalent of saying finding a flat earther who keeps climbing buildings, scaling the wall of buildings to prove that the earth is flat. If the media caught hold of somebody like that, it'd be great news to say, here's this guy, he's scaling this 10-story building to prove that the earth is flat. Hilarious. And then they know that if somebody keeps scaling the side of a building, as he goes higher and higher, eventually that person will fall. So it's a great story every time. Now he's going to scale a 15-story building. Now a 20-story building. Now because there's no end game. There's nothing like, oh, he finally scaled to the top and can see that the earth is flat. No. And we all know that. That's why he's not a flat earther. That's why he wasn't even trying to prove flat earth. That's why he himself says he's not a flat earther. And eventually he does the inevitable. So RIP, he went out the way that he loved living. I mean, I can't say that he didn't love doing what he's doing. There's no way you would keep doing that unless you got some sort of thrill out of it, and at least he went the way he would want to go, I'm guessing. So
exactly. And the other interesting thing is, in this very same article, you know, they show the tragedy and they talk about it and, you know, give an update. Well, first of all, they're very vague about it. It's believed to possibly be dead. And then, you know, finally at about 4 o'clock, they've confirmed that he in fact died. But then, you know, they put in the very same article, this clip by, what's his name? Jack, I don't remember what his name is. Anyway, he's a clown that makes fun of flat earthers. And, you know, he was saying that, you know, about, Mad Mike, you know, what a complete idiot he was. And, you know, Darwin Award candidate, they put all this stuff in the very same article. Yeah. So it's like, you know, that's just bizarre, honestly.
Yeah, that's what I think. It's kind of very dark about this.
Yep.
And debating and using people with the death of somebody and making fun of them and stuff. It's all kind of bad. Go ahead, Austin.
I will say the reaction you hear in the video does seem a little mild. And I also just have to say, like, what is the ideal, you know, manifestation of this experiment? You know, like, what would have ideally happened?
Good question.
I thought that maybe the reason why people could be cheering the fall of the rocket is that they expected it to fall anyway, and maybe they expected him to parachute off and that he would be coming down shortly or something like that, but then he didn't. So you know, it could be this, but that's the only best reason I could think of.
So the plan, ultimately, best case scenario, is you shoot the rocket up, and then it comes down and it crashes and destroys itself, and you just float down after going to – yeah, that just seems odd to me. Like, well, okay.
Has everyone watched the documentary Rocket Man or no?
I have.
I haven't.
Yeah. I mean,
it actually wasn't bad, honestly. It was,
yeah, and I think I even told you that my wife shed a tear at the end. Because this is a guy who loved doing that. And so, I mean, you at least watch that documentary.
Mm-hmm. He really loved it. You could tell. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, he just...
Okay. It makes sense. The adrenaline of going up there, just the experience of it, he enjoyed doing it, and he floats down, and then those people didn't put together that the parachute fell, or maybe he had another one, and that's why the reaction was kind of mild. Sure, that makes sense.
Could be.
I'm certainly not saying I know for a fact he was in there. I have no idea. I'm sitting at my house just like you guys, so... But, it just seems to me like this was inevitable. It's like when I got the text message yesterday, it wasn't like I thought, you've got to be kidding me. There's no possible way. I got the text message like, well, okay, yeah, that's what's going to happen. It keeps launching him. What else is going to happen?
I think it is even crazier, those guys that climb mountain with no rope, you know, that's like called free whatever, like free climbing. I mean, and they know that many of them die, actually. Many of them die. And they do it because they love it. It's the same thing.
Yeah. Yep. All right. Okay, guys. Well, let's wrap that up and enough about that. And, you know, all I can say is condolences to the family. Rest in peace, Mad Mike. But please do not tie him to Flat Earth, because he was not a Flat Earther. And nor does anybody really want to claim him, as far as I know, unless they're trying to discredit the Flat Earth. But, as a human being, you know, it's a tragedy. Very sad. All right. So let's move on to the main subject matter, the impossible mainstream gravitational model. And the reason that I'm doing this, guys, is, you know, we talked a little bit about this on Friday in the Journalism Lounge. And one of the things that I think Austin and I both take great exception with is that, it is the inclination of many flat earthers to dismiss in its entirety the idea that gravity even exists at all. Now, there's a lot of controversy on, you know, the definition of what gravity is. I would prefer to call it an acceleration that is earthward. It's something that I think is frankly undeniable. A lot of people say that that is not necessary to have any type of force or acceleration to cause things to go to Earth, which, you know, to me is very non sequitur, doesn't make any sense at all, because things fall down. They don't go up. They don't go sideways. There's something that determines up from down. And really, that's what this whole debate kind of centers around. Now, the reason I believe that flat earthers have the stigma against gravity is because of the way that it has been misapplied to things that are going on allegedly in space. The ISS being slung around the Earth at 17,500 miles an hour. The moon being slung around the Earth at, you know, whatever speed it is. The Earth being slung around the sun, and all the other planets being slung around the sun. That is when it gets into the absolute absurd. And what I'm going to show today is that mainstream really has nothing to base this on. Mainstream gives us mathematical equations that honestly straight up are based more on electrical equations, which are frankly identical to electric force equations, and try to apply these equations towards objects in outer space using the gravitational force, which quite frankly, even admitted by the mainstream, is 10 to the negative 37th or 10 to the 37th times weaker than the so-called equivalent static or electric force, right? Also, the gravitational force is supposedly has to obey the inverse square law, you know, just like magnetism and any type of EM radiation or anything like that. Well, when you start thinking about that, about the utter and complete total weakness of this field, and think that it diminishes on a basis that is proportional to the inverse square law. And of course, we've done a lot of things with the inverse square law, you know, like the moon, which is, you know, something like 14 quadrillion times brighter at the moon surface, supposedly, according to the inverse square law, than it is here at one lux or one lumen on Earth. Obviously, you can see the scale of what we're dealing here, and also the scale of the deception that's going on behind it. So, Austin and I and Ken Wheeler and many other people have talked about the idea that gravitational forces are more akin to something that would be like an incoherent magnetic field. Zach, Good Times for All, has made some beautiful videos on that. We have been consulted by a PhD electrical engineer that gives us this information and, you know, has guided us through, you know, looking at this, which is great. There are debates going on. Gravity is nothing but an incoherent magnetic field distribution. Things like this are very interesting. Ultimately, by the way, the guy that's promoting it as an incoherent magnetic field wins the debate. This is something that will be in the show notes. But I mean, to say that it's not being talked about would be absolutely untrue. A lot of people are on board with this idea. The other thing that we've discovered about incoherent magnetic fields is that as you increase the incoherency of the field or add more and more magnets to the mass, if you will, that rather than increase the magnetic pull or the electrostatic pull, it decreases. This is something that is shown experimentally to be a fact. So the mainstream notion that the bigger, the more mass an object has, the more gravitational pull it exhibits is absolutely false, and they have absolutely nothing to demonstrate that as being true, other than their reference to the Earth. And we're about ready to tear that a new one here very shortly. But what's most interesting about it, like I said, is all the equations that they use to prove their alleged gravitational model and a gravitational field, ironically, is the equations are exactly the same as they would be used for electrostatic models. Okay, this is really, really super interesting. And where was that? Let me see if I can find that. It doesn't matter. All right. Oh well, here we have the similarities of forces. From looking at the two force equations, you can see the similarities in how gravitational force can be considered parallel to the force between two charges. Right. And like I said, the equations are virtually identical.
So it's all some metaphors going on between electrostatic, electric, and gravitation that's going on there.
Totally. Exactly. And right. It's all to cause confusion, right, about what's actually happening. The mm-hmm. irony is even when they compute these things, as we're going to see here very shortly, they will compute it and use the gravitational forces measured out in newtons. And what's ironic is when you convert newtons to electron volts or anything like that, you get absolute numbers that should be able to be measured. But you know what? They're not. They can't measure any so-called gravitational field. So what they have to resort to is things like LIGO, which is another complete farce that is saying that, well, when a gravitational wave, the way that they can measure this field is when it goes through, a tunnel, a 4-kilometer tunnel, and it physically shortens it by 1/1000th the width of a proton. All of a sudden, that's proof of gravity. It's like, guys, you got to be kidding me. They tell us that our atmosphere is held on to the Earth, right? Supposedly, by this gravitational pull. Well, great. So even if that was true, what's happening is by the time you get up to, 200,000-300,000 feet, the atmosphere is so thin, right, that there's virtually nothing there. So you would think that if the gravitational force was so strong that it wouldn't even make it that high, right? It would all be highly concentrated right next to the ground, right? But instead, what they will tell us is that gravitational force, even though it can't seem to pull all of that stuff out of the upper levels of our atmosphere, It still has enough power, even being subject to the inverse square law, to be able to hurl the moon and the space station and anything else around it caught in this gravitational lasso. It's
but that
absolutely...
doesn't make that doesn't make any sense, right? The inverse square law. How can it hold the moon, which is very far away, if the inverse square law then should be saying that it should hold us much stronger to the ground, right? And it doesn't.
Exactly. Same with the sun. How is the sun slinging around planets that are, you know, a couple billion miles away? How is it capturing them and holding it in this gravitational field? And all the time, all the while, ladies and gentlemen, we cannot measure this field. There is no field to measure. Now, when you deal with electrostatics or electromagnetics, you can measure the field in Teslas. You can measure the field in electron volts. It is absolutely there. But when we're talking about gravity, brother, there is nothing there that can be measured, period. Right? So, and why do they do all of their math and computations if it was not, in fact, based on electricity? That's the great mystery, right? So
they measure things falling, right? They have those things that they do that, right? But it's some sort of inference, right? It's a different thing that's going on. It's not the actual thing that's doing it, right? It's something falling
precisely.
And then going backward toward it. And I was going to ask you, like, the scale, the inverse square law, when you talk about the moon, when you get those like crazy number of lumens, that's computing the mainstream distance, right?
Yes, that's computing. There's two things. Ben, when he did it at 1 lux. I took the Wikipedia figured, which gives the mainstream the benefit of the doubt at 0.1 lux, or, you know, 1/10 of a lux, and you compute it backwards. And by the time you get to the surface of the moon, it is literally 14 point something quadrillion lumens. There is nothing that is that bright that we can even imagine. It's just
so the distance is wrong, right?
The distance, everything about it is wrong, right? You know, take your pick, right?
But do you think it would work like with the inverse square law, where the distance much shorter, you wouldn't get to those crazy lumens? It would be more reasonable or not?
It would be somewhat more reasonable, but then again, you know, you'd have to bring it way closer. Maybe a couple thousand miles. Gee, isn't that a coincidence? And we could certainly do the math and, you know, backward engineer it. That wouldn't be difficult. But even then, you know, we're talking about something that when the astronauts were supposedly standing on the surface of the moon, if they would have been exposed to 14 quadrillion lumens of light, it would have vaporized them. I mean, period. Would have vaporized them, right? There's just no way that could possibly happen. So again, the gravitational so-called field, which is not a field at all because it can't be measured, and they have to go, you know, like I've said a million times, in order to prove the so-called gravitational field, they have to go to an event that happened a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, where, you know, 450 million light years back, there were two neutron stars that collided, two black holes, whatever, and, you know, the collision of these two things created this gravitational wave that was sent out over the cosmos for, you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, that arrives on Earth. And even though it supposedly has, you know, orders of magnitude more gravitational strength than the moon, which of course is lifting up trillions of tons of oceans, nothing happened. You would have thought that all hell would have broken loose, right? Being hit by a gravitational wave like that. Was there? No, not a damn thing happened, right? Mm-hmm. And again, I've said it before. Why doesn't LIGO pick up the gravitational field from the moon? Why? Right. Because there isn't one, okay? All right, so what we're going to do is I'm going to play a latest video by Zach Good Times for All. As you know, Zach has been staying with us for quite some time, and it's great. So getting him a computer is one of the best things that I ever did because he's turned into quite a really good video maker. And I'm going to play this one. It's only a minute and 40 seconds. But what he's going to do is he's going to show an MIT professor, who we all know who he is, Walter Lewin. And Walter Lewin is essentially saying, hey, you know what? what's holding everything together right down here is the force of electricity. And he says, it's only when you get out to the stars that things are taken over by gravity. And of course, this is completely unproven. We don't know any of this, and we have no evidence whatsoever, but it's in the curriculum, so he has to teach it. Yeah.
It's amazing.
So let's give Zach a listen here and on this video on Walter Lewin, and let you guys decide. Here we go, guys.
Hello, everybody out there in YouTube land. This is Good Times for All, or Zachary Zabala here if you prefer. In this video, we're going to ask a question. Does this MIT professor confirm electric gravity?
I don't know what the hell holds the nucleus together. If there is such a tremendous force on these protons, well, what is holding them together are the nuclear forces, which we do not fully understand, but thank goodness, the nuclear forces are not part of 802, so I'll leave that alone for now. So what holds our world together? Well, on the nuclear scale, 10 to the minus 12 centimeters, very important are the nuclear forces. On an atomic scale, up to thousands of kilometers, it's really electric forces that hold our world together. But on a much larger scale, planets and stars and the galaxy, it is gravity that holds our world together. But on a much larger scale, planets and stars and the galaxy, it is gravity that holds our world together.
Okay, and one thing Zach wanted me to show was, and he's going to remake this video, and he's going to put this part into it where he essentially says right after it that, well, here, let me just play it. Here we go.
15 meters, and you calculate this ratio, you will find that it is 26 orders of magnitude higher than the gravitational acceleration on Earth. 26 orders of magnitude higher. So you wonder what the hell holds the nucleus together? If there is such a tremendous force on these protons, well, what is holding them together are the nuclear forces, which we do not fully understand, but thank goodness the nuclear forces are not part of 802, so I'll leave that alone for now. So what holds our world together? Well, on the nuclear scale, 10 to the minus 12 centimeters, very important are the nuclear forces. On an atomic scale, up to thousands of kilometers, it's really electric forces that hold our world together. But on a much larger scale, planets and stars and the galaxy, it is gravity that holds our world together. And now you may say, ah, that's very inconsistent with what you just told us, because didn't you tell us that D cancels if you compare gravity with electricity?
Yes, but keep in mind that most objects in the universe have only a very small amount of charge per unit mass.
Okay, so basically, you know, what Zach wanted me to point out there was the inconsistency of the arguments that even Walter Lewin himself and the mainstream have to address when it comes to gravitational versus electrodynamic type of forces, right? Again, there is absolutely no field to measure. You know, the only thing they can do with gravity is describe what it does. What does it do? Well, it accelerates things at approximately 9.8 meters per second squared towards the Earth. All right, great. So, and again, like I said, you look
at... What about dark energy and all this, Bob? Like, how does it, is it not supposed to supplant gravity and do also some pulling of its own?
Yes, that was the entire reason why dark energy was introduced, is because of the fact that they know full well that gravitational forces could not possibly slingshot Earth around the sun or the Milky Way around the center of the galaxy, the Great Attractor. It cannot happen. It simply does not have the force required to do so. I think this is also another reason why they came out with the incredibly stupid model of bendy space-time. Right? again, it's just obfuscating the entire issue that people are questioning this, so they have to come up with something that's even more absurd that people cannot possibly understand and obfuscate that. But like I said, here you have it. When you look at the gravitational and electrostatic forces and the equations that govern them, they are virtually identical, right? So, and yet you can actually measure electrostatic forces. They're actually measurable. You can measure electromagnetic forces. They're absolutely measurable. When Austin and I talk about dielectric acceleration, like what Ken Wheeler talks about, when you're talking about dielectricity, we're talking about a composite of magnetic and electrical energy, right? And we know experimentally that if you make any electrostatic energy incoherent, it becomes weaker. If you make any magnetic energy incoherent, it becomes weaker. So why in the world, you know, based with everything being all the same, they could make the ridiculous assertion that when you increase your mass, you're actually increasing gravitational attraction? That's absurd, right? Sorry, doesn't work. What we do know...
Can you explain a little bit just the difference between the electric and the magnetic? And well, or the similarities, or whether is it different at all?
Well, the electrostatic forces are obviously in, you know, in the realm of electricity, and they are very complementary to one another. So in other words, they're kind of two heads, or in Ken Wheeler's case, he describes gravity, electrostatics, and magnetics as three heads of the same hydra. But let's just look at magnetics and electrostatics, right? When you have a magnetic field and you take and you cut that magnetic field across a conductor, what will happen is it will induce an electrical current flow in it, okay? Mm-hmm. Conversely, if you have an electrical current that is propagating through a conductor, around that electrical conductor, that coaxial circuit, if you will, it will generate a magnetic field. So they are two, you cannot have one without the other, right? Mm-hmm. Now,
that's what I was thinking, yeah. That we treat them almost separately for some reason, which is another one of those ways in which terminology gets in the way.
Right. Well, they're essentially the same thing. They're the same type of energy. They're this dielectric energy or this etheric manipulation, but they are in different modalities, right? Meaning it's kind of like when you have ice, you have water. You have water in a state where it's liquid. You have water in a state of ice where it's, you know, a solid. Or you have water in the state of steam where it's a gas. Or is it? It's all just water. It's simply water in a different modality. So apply this to electrostatics, electromagnetics, and this supposed gravitational force, which nobody is denying that there is a downward acceleration. But what is causing that? It isn't this completely new and unproven thing called gravity. It is a product of electricity and magnetism. The only reason that we are even allowing it to be called gravity is because it does, in fact, create an acceleration towards the Earth. This is undeniable. Mm-hmm. Right.
But it depends on some few things, right, Bobby? Like some things go up, and then some people obviously point that out. Not sure it's an elephant in the room, but they'll say, yeah, helium goes up, and or underwater you go up instead of going down, and things like that need to be accounted for.
I totally agree, and you know, and that's some of the things that I've kind of addressed on the Jaronism Lounge is the question that I asked my friend, the PhD electrical engineer. You know, I gave him the whole spiel about, you know, helium. And isn't it interesting that you know, the mainstream explanation for it is, you know, this buoyancy, it's more buoyant. But my point was, again, and I want people to really think about this, is that if you have two balloons and they're not blown up at all, you drop them, they both fall to the ground at the same time. If you blow them both up with air, let them go, well, they kind of float down to the ground because there's an element of buoyancy going on there. Now, if you take helium and you take an empty metal container and you fill it up with helium, guess what? The weight of that container actually increases, right? Why? Because helium has mass. Helium has weight. But when you put it inside of a balloon and you blow it up to an identical volume on the outside, the helium goes up and the air will still go down. Well, why is that? Well, again, the mainstream is saying that this is a product of it being more buoyant. I've looked at other possibilities in that helium and hydrogen are both diamagnetic, and they are essentially repulsed by electromagnetic fields. Am I right? Mm. I don't know. But
it
just,
I suspect it makes sense for me. I don't know what you guys think.
Yeah,
Bob,
exactly.
Bob, would you agree that a big distinction that I think a lot of people kind of conflate is the difference in little g and big G, which is essentially what that professor's explaining. Little g is the local acceleration on Earth that we see, and we're just trying to properly define it. And then they have a little fantasy force that they've come up with on the side to explain space. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I would say that's reasonable.
Right, so that's just kind of how I see it. I don't think downward acceleration is obviously inevitable, and then I agree with exactly what you're saying. It's got an electrostatic component, and then that's what that professor's like conceding that, right? The downward acceleration seems to be electric, but when we get into la-la land, then there's this other force. And so I think that's kind of why people freak out. They're like, I've been trying so long to dismantle this nonsense gravity that they don't want anything to do with it, and they don't understand the distinction, you know?
Exactly. And like I said, my problem with that is, you know, there are people going around in this community saying gravity, this acceleration doesn't exist. Everything is explained by relative density, even going so far as to claim that relative density is a force. That is the dumbest thing I have ever heard in my life. That is simply not true. Accelerometers or gravimeters actually prove that. And I can safely say that because these high dollar test equipments, which are based on laser interferometry, will show different acceleration rates at different places on the Earth. Again, is it this mystical gravity that appears, you know, that is only claimed by science to exist, or is it caused by the electromagnetic/electrostatic/dielectric acceleration that Ken Wheeler talks about, that you and I have talked about, Austin? It seems to me that when you're talking about dielectricity, magnetism, and electricity, that's something that is absolutely measurable. That's something that is absolutely provable. And it's also something that we can apply towards objects, and we can either levitate them, we can either repulse them, or we can attract them. Why? Because everything in the universe has an electrical charge potential to it. So it only makes sense.
One question, Bob.
Yes.
If you talk about repulsion, how fast can you accelerate if people try to accelerate things by just repelling them electromagnetically?
Well, that would be proportional to the force applied to it. You know, like a rail gun, for example, if you accelerate a projectile with a rail gun, it'll kick something up to, God, what is it, 3 miles a second? It's a ridiculous speed.
Right. But it's just magnetic repulsion.
Exactly. It's a collimated magnetic type of propulsion that obviously is directly proportional to the amount of Tesla magnetic fields that they are putting towards it, as well as the coherency, you know, as it's being fired down that rail, right? So it is directly proportional to the amount of energy that's being put into it.
How fast you say?
I think they're up to like 3 miles a second, something. I may be wrong on that, but I can tell you this. It's faster than all get out, and they can hit a target over 100 miles away. So, yeah, somebody could actually look that up. I may be wrong at 3 miles a second. Whatever it is, it's really, really fast. Okay.
Bob, let me ask you this, just see what you say. If there was a universal down, so that is a given, let's say, there is a basement of the universe, could relative density then be a force?
No, relative density still would not be a force. However, relative density, after that bias is set, and I said this since day one, relative density absolutely then determines the ordering of things. But you still have to have that initial bias. There must be a down.
So I'm saying if there is a universal down, there is a basement of the universe. So just like there's some things that we just have to accept are the way they are. So let's just say there is a universal down. Then couldn't relative density be a force itself?
Why not? I wouldn't say so, because relative density is nothing more than that. It is the difference of mass density from one material to another. That does not constitute itself as a force. There has to be something externally acting upon it.
Together with the density, Bob, isn't there also some level of electro repulsion or something like that that we describe as density? Like, say, hydrophobic, you know, how oil separate from water. Is it just density? Is there something else to it that's electromagnetic as well?
Honestly, I don't know. I would say there's a possibility of that. But I think density is the best explanation for it, buoyancy and density. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I have nothing against the buoyancy and density argument. They are absolutely valid, but they simply are not a force. You know, there's something, you know, it, just like the Vomit Comet demonstration. If you take away that downward acceleration by, you know, essentially zeroing out the G, then the liquids do not want to mix. But if you continue pushing that plane over where it pushes things to the ceiling, what will then happen is those liquids will order in the opposite direction. And to me, that's pretty conclusive, telling you that there has got to be a bias there in the first place, something that is absolutely determining up from down.
And that'll be the... Right, but the density also becomes apparent with that little experiment there.
Very much so. But what I'm saying, and what Austin, I'm sure, is saying, is we're saying that it is not this thing called gravity in as far as the way the mainstream is defining it, right? Gravity, quote unquote, is an electrical / magnetic or dielectric type of acceleration. You know, Ken Wheeler says this, and again, dielectricity and magnetism and electricity is something we can actually measure. We can actually get a field strength from it. You cannot get that from so-called gravity. It doesn't exist. That's why they have to come out with these retarded things like, oh, well, gravitational waves pass through something. They shrink the size. They shrink by the size of a thousandth of a proton. That is absurd. They do the math for electricity. They do the math for magnetism. It's the exact same equations. For God's sakes, why don't they just admit it's an electrical force? Right?
do you want to hear something interesting, which is the quote that I found in this History of Science book? I think you're going to think this is interesting.
Okay.
I think it's a good segue into it. Okay, so they're talking about, basically what he's talking about is scientific paradigm shifts and how they change your perspective. Kind of like goggles, actually. He uses even the metaphor, but then he goes through many different so-called scientific revolutions, you know, how this changes the set of problems that people are focusing on. He says that, you know, scientists, they're trained to be puzzle solvers and not paradigm testers. That is one of the things he says. But then when it comes to Newton, he gives an example here. Or again, Newton wrote that Galileo had discovered that the constant force of gravity produces a motion proportional to the square of the time. In fact, Galileo's kinematic theorem does state that form when embedded in the matrix of Newton's own dynamical concepts. But Galileo said nothing of the sort. His discussion of falling bodies rarely alludes to forces, much less to a uniform gravitational force that causes bodies to fall. By crediting to Galileo the answer to a question that Galileo's paradigms did not permit to be asked, Newton's account hides the effect of a small but revolutionary reformulation in the questions the scientists asked about motion, as well as in the answers they felt able to accept.
Hmm. Interesting.
From my understanding, Newton didn't even really postulate a definitive explanation. And then, kind of like touching on what Jaren's saying, the way that I understand it, at least, is I'm just like kind of trying my best to understand what the fatherheads of the electrical field theory thought of gravity as just an effect. And then the only force, if you will, would be the magnetism, because it's a field. But the gravity is just an effect, and then the density is a factor into what the effect is going to be. But it isn't actually causing it, and then there's just the natural absolute frame of reference, and something falls, and then because it is electrostatic, it's an electrostatic, or more specifically, dielectric acceleration, and the gravity is just an effect that's negligible, and it's electrical. That's at least the way I understand it.
You guys are way beyond the Newtonian paradigm by now. The way you talk about it, like, I mean, gravity that he was talking about is very, very, very different, right? And this is one of the point here of what I just read is that, you know, someone comes up with an idea that they think is universal, And then they can look back at the works of others and say, oh, here, he proved me right. And then they go on to make different claims, right? And then the people that follow that tradition then start applying the same set of problems to solve the same kind of theory, right? And that can get passed along as a tradition. That has nothing to do with the actual nature of things, right? Mm-hmm. In this case, it is a neutral Newton having no idea, no sense of electrostatic, you know, and that would come later for people. But still, you know, the idea here that gravity somehow survived, and he talks about it here as well, like that there's these heroes of science that they, you know, line up one after the other, as if there's this natural, easy progression from one finding to another. Whereas in fact, when you start reading what they're saying, you get much more gray areas. It is much more complicated, and it's not so simple as the textbooks. And this is the main point of this book here, is the centrality of textbooks, textbook writing, and how they basically formulate everything for the trainee. And then there's a bunch of other problems, but that's what holds back science, like the lack of historical knowledge of the scientific process itself, so-called scientific process, right? These changes in so-called paradigm shifts that we have now, but the history itself is key to uncovering.
I absolutely agree, Rodrigo. And, you know, that's just like the Michelson-Gale, Michelson-Morley, you know, understanding the true nature of those experiments and the Sandiac, mm-hmm. you know, bringing forth the truth of the ether, right? And let's, right. you know, let's just cut to the chase here and talk about what's really going on here. And Ken Wheeler is nuts on when he says this. It's all about pressure mediation, right? That's what's going on. That's what gravity is. That's what electricity is. That's what magnetism is. It's all about this pressure mediation. Right. So
exactly.
What's interesting is that the mainstream, for whatever reason,
what does that mean exactly? The pressure mediation.
Well, it's basically a balancing of forces, and when you cause a disequilibrium in forces, right? Specifically the ether in this case, and of course we talked about the ether and how, you know, at least in my view, and I think in several other people's view also, the literal nature of matter is a cymatic manipulation of the ether. You know, on specific frequencies. You can tie this biblically to the word of God, right? The complexity of these sound vibrations, so to speak, of God's voice, manipulating the ether and literally manifesting form. And it is amazing when you look at cymatics, what kind of forms can be manifested just by mixing up a few different vibrations, right?
I think you're talking about those experiments with different kind of shape things that like are chocolate or whatever that they start almost looks like
creatures.
Exactly. Yeah.
Exactly. Uh-huh. And think about this for a second. What's happening cymatically there, right? You are you're vibrating these like lyco powder and things like this. And what's mm-hmm. happening is you're mediating the pressure. You're causing different pressure formations uh-huh. around that lyco powder, which is giving it form. Same thing mm-hmm. with the ether. This is what pressure mediation is in the grand scheme of things as far as mm-hmm. you know, cymatic creation through the ether. Okay, my opinion, but
interesting.
You know,
yeah, I agree with that, Bob.
good.
I've been out for a while. Sorry.
Okay.
And I just wanted to throw in there a sonoluminescence with the lights in the sky. A lot of people, myself included, think that's an interesting theory as for the explanation of the lights in the sky because. Of sonoluminescence through water, you can replicate basically what they call a star in a jar, and I'm sure you've covered it a number of times before.
Mm-hmm.
But with waters, you can create a plasma point, and that's basically through pressure, as I understand it as well.
Yes, mm-hmm. It's just like Tesla said from the get-go. When you're looking at the nature of the universe, think in terms of frequency and vibration. Yeah. No truer words were spoken, folks. You know,
would you say, Bob, that sonoluminescence is quite similar in a different level to this kind of cymatic mediation that we see with the other pastes and so on?
Absolutely. It's in fact, it's the very same thing. The sonoluminescence essentially is caused by this cavitation of a liquid, right? which causes specific pressure points. Again, we're going back to this pressure mediation, right? Which is causing a fluorescing or a luminescence of the water. So again, it flies in the ether. It flies in cymatics in LICO powder. And it certainly seems to make sense that it would behave the same way with the luminiferous ether. And the voice of God, if you will, speaking things into literal form or literal creation. It just makes sense to me.
Does the sonoluminescence itself, does it have voltage in it? What is it doing? Is it creating a magnetic field of its own as well? Do you know about this?
I would assume that it must. I mean, I don't have the specifics on it, but we know that it generates light, and light, is a form of electromagnetism. And what do we know about electromagnetism and electricity? It goes back to the same thing. Where there's magnetism, there's electricity. They are two heads of the same hydra. So,
And from the perspective of light, which is more of my area of expertise, the light produced from the star in a jar, the sun luminescence, is the same characteristic light that you get from the similar thing produced via electricity in the case of an electric arc lamp.
Yes.
Which is the first light that was ever made in supposedly the early 1800s, I think around 1828, I think they were doing them in laboratories, according to the historical narrative. These old street lamps that they had around the time of the advent of photography, those are electric arc lamps, and they produce a spectrum that is equivalent to the star in the jar that if you do in your home laboratory, you need to protect as you would a welder's arc, because again, it's about the same exact profile of light. There's a lot of UV in there, and it's a broad spectrum radiation.
Exactly, UAP. And another way to look at that is, when I was 16, I used to work at a drive-in theater, right? I worked in the snack bar, but we got to go up to the projection room, and this may still be this way today, I don't know. But when we went up to the projection room and looked at the projectors, what they had was two carbon rods that they put a voltage through together, and then it would create the spectacular arc, super bright light, and that's what provided the light source to project onto the drive-in theater. Same thing if you think about a modern day arc welder, right? What are they doing? I mean, when they're welding and they're generating this unbelievable amount of light, it's because of arcing electricity. Same thing.
And it'll sunburn you. It'll kill all the germs around, and it's extremely bright, like looking into the sun, right? Those are very durable lights, and you can find them around still. The projectors, those are the carbon rods. They're about, what were they, like a quarter inch apart, the rods?
Yep.
And they just had an arc, and it puts out a lot of heat, maybe a little bit of smoke even.
But a lot of light.
Extremely bright.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, again, that's what I'm saying. All of this seems to be a product of electricity and magnetism, something we can measure, something we can manipulate, something that we seem to have full control of, or at least a big amount of control of. And they want to attribute this, these forces, these accelerations, to something that simply is fabricated. I mean, the gravity that they say is something different. I mean, a lot of people, they will try and tell you that gravity is not magnetism. It is not electricity. And yet they will, like, I'm about to play this video, which is unbelievable the way they describe this. But again, that's all we can measure. That's all we can actually do. And when you take the electrical and magnetism calculations, they are applying them exactly the same way to this gravitational field, except they will then turn right around in the same breath and say, well, it's 10 to the 37th times weaker. Well, then how in the hell does it get anything done? That's why the guys at the Thunderbolts project are saying, no, you know, the universe as it is, and granted, they're still in some sort of a heliocentric model. They're saying that there is no way that gravity could possibly do this. Even the mainstream admits it. That's why they have to admit stupid stuff like dark matter, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So now
can I add to that?
Oh, sure. Go ahead.
Well, just to give everybody an idea of how weak of a force this is, you hear a lot about the Cavendish experiment. And when I had a little back and forth with Scott Manley in emails about the nature of gravity, and he was citing the Cavendish experiment, which I researched and found that it was meant to be a proof of concept experiment, like a demonstration for somebody else to take the lead and replicate and reproduce, which right. I didn't believe had been done to any satisfaction. But then he produced some studies that were peer reviewed and accepted, which I read. It was very tedious reading, and the kinds of assumptions that had to be made to allow for them to, in my view, back their way into the gravitational constant that had been agreed upon by committee over the years. I forgot the name of the society that meets. You know, there's so much made of like this flat earth society. Well, okay, that's not a real society. The real societies are the ones that meet and decide, okay, the big G, the gravitational constant, you know, the OG of gravity, the original gangster number of gravity that they agreed upon, that happened by committee, and it's adjusted a little bit over the years, supposedly based on accuracy, but it's just them taking a bunch of experiments that do not have overlapping results of accuracy, of precision, rather. Accuracy.
How can something be a constant that has different measurements, like Bob was pointing out, gravimetry, you find different anomalies, how can it be a constant?
Exactly. That's why they had to meet and have the committee and basically get, it's like getting together before you get questions separately by the cops. You know, this is right. Our story. Okay, this is G, this number, you know, back your way into it and you get an award, or you get your experiment peer review, gold, you know, green stamped,
right.
Gold starred even.
And well, I was just going to say, and one thing that I want everybody to realize is when they start looking into these so-called gravitational anomalies, there's all kinds of places around the world where, you know, gravity is kind of wonky, right? It things like cars will roll uphill instead of down. And of course, the gravimeters will measure dramatically different accelerations at this point. And I will say this for the record, when you look into this, that every one of these sites also has, coincidentally, I don't think so, a magnetic anomaly that is directly associated with it.
Right, like an iron deposit or something like that. Yeah. Yeah, they have those mapped out. Is that what you mean, like those gravity maps?
Yes. And the magnetic field in those areas is just as anomalous. Gee, that would almost indicate that, wow, somehow they're tied together.
Yep, you know? Yep, exactly. And so they say, this is where they get into this whole discussion of gravity. Oftentimes I see them talk about frames of reference. And that is like a Jedi waving his hand and saying, you know, you only need to consider this and not these other things, which is so unscientific. Well, they talk about the Cavendish experiment, and they talk about the frames of reference eliminating everything except the two metal balls hanging and how do they swing together or rotate around, that type of thing. To give you an idea, when I really looked into these studies and spent hours and hours reading the fine print and everything else with the assumptions, to give everybody an idea of how weak the gravity force is, they talked about light pressure. And what I mean by that is the light in the room during the experiment, to them, in their view, exerted a pressure on the objects being tested that affected their position. So, so like you turn on your fluorescent light and it pushes on the object that they're measuring. That's the level of variable that they're dealing with, that they're claiming they've accounted for all of it. And it's just a little bit crazy to measure a force that's that weak and then to go on the other hand and say it's slinging around, slingshotting planets and satellites and everything else.
And that's the whole, you know, trick. They're not measuring a force. They're measuring the behavior of something, the characteristics, the attributes of it. In other words, you know, if I take a pen and I drop it to the table, I'm not measuring any force. What I'm doing is I'm observing and I'm applying mathematics to what I'm observing. It's not measuring anything. It's observing and applying the appropriate mathematical equations to describe what's happening. There is no force to measure.
And the description doesn't work out mathematically. And that's why they had to introduce the dark matter, where you end up having the best mouthpiece being Neil deGrasse Tyson on some show explaining that there could be gravity spilling out from another universe in the multiverse. That's their explanation for it. It's just absurd. And if you haven't thrown your papers down and kicked your desk over and walked out by then you never will.
Exactly.
Isn't it ironic how they have this light pressure and the sun doesn't exert light pressure on the Earth, and then it has gravity instead?
Well, there is
this experiment.
It's not in the frame of reference, so they don't because right. They haven't really solved the three-body problem. You know, you have the Earth, the Moon, and the Sun, and the Moon's going to slingshot the Earth. You're going to feel yourself, okay, are we in the – just like instead of just like the tides or something, you would be saying, well, are we going faster today around the Sun, or are we slowing down? And it's not observable in any way because they haven't observed it, but then they say, well, it's not within the frame of reference. It's negligible because of the differences in mass, but it's not. If the Moon weighs as much as the Earth and the Sun, then these effects would be seen. But even light pressure on the scale of the entire half of the Earth that would be measurable, I would think it would be significant enough, but to my knowledge, it's never been quantified.
Yeah, exactly. So
this all reminds me of I don't know if you guys remember a video I did about a year ago called Cosmology Has Some Big Problems.
Mm-hmm.
He remembers that. It was a Scientific American article, but everything that we're talking about is covered really extensively in that article by somebody who's even in their own world, who explained how everything is basically ad hoc to explain something that's fundamentally wrong. And this is somebody in their own line of research that it can admit why we have dark energy, can admit why we have dark matter, can admit why none of these things have any empirical evidence whatsoever. And yet it's all just to basically, you know, fill some mathematical unification and to make the science seem complete. But it's not. It's got so many errors, but you can always with mass, just with math, add something else. You can always just rework the formulas. So anyway, people should check that out. Maybe I'll re-release it because it was good. I don't remember when that was posted, probably about a year ago.
Yeah, it was a great video. Absolutely. Yeah, you should re-release it.
What they did, I'm not sure if it was right after that, Jaron, but like I think it was about 2 years ago when they came out with their LIGO results, where supposedly this is experimentally proven some of the claims that Einstein made over 100 years ago. Yep. And it's another example of something that is billions of dollars, that's off limits, it's underground, it's huge. You're supposed to just accept that experiment. But it falls into that category of everything else that they've used for their
experimental evidence, you know, just there isn't. It's not something that is
what about something we can reproduce. What about the retrograde motions of some of the lights that we see, like Mars and so on? That, yeah, would it be explained in the Ptolemaic way? And then that would that be magnetic then?
Yeah, the answer to that, Rodrigo, is absolutely not. In fact, all they're doing, again, by the observation of those lights, they cannot solve even a three-body problem. So to assume that they could take all those planetary motions and all the beautiful, you know, geometric patterns that they form and how they're interacting with each other, they can't not even describe it mathematically, let alone solve it. In other words, they're just trying to make you think like they can do that and that gravity magically does all this. We don't know what those lights are other than they're lights, but are they terra firma? Not a chance, in my opinion. And but they have to incorporate this as part of their lie, part of their fantasy, and bring it about. So before we get much further, guys, what I want to do is I want to play this video by Bozeman Science, and I want you guys to pay attention to Poindexter here when he's talking about this gravitational field. Well, there is no field, guys. There is no field of gravity. There is nothing to be measured in that field. Again, the only thing they're doing is they're taking a description and applying a mathematics to a description of something that is observed. They are not measuring a field. There is no field to measure. Versus, you know, if I want to measure a magnetic field, I can do that. You know, you can do that with your phone. If I want to measure a static field, electrostatic field, I can do that. That's real. That's tangible. It's manipulable. And, you know, this so-called gravitational field is not real. It's contrived. And it's brought about by observing something that is caused by dielectric inertial acceleration. But just listen to how they obfuscate this and make you think that this field is something that is actually tangible when it flat out is not. Here we go. Oh, and by the way, this is being used for educational purposes under fair use for critique, commentary, education, yada, yada, yada. Okay, here we go.
Hi, it's Mr. Anderson, and this is AP Physics Essentials 25. It's on gravitational field strength, which is a measure of the gravitational force placed on an object that's in a gravitational field. And so you know that the moon orbits around the Earth and stays there because of this gravitational field. And so if we place it in orbit, watch how the force on those two objects remains constant. The gravitational field strength is the same. But if we were to play around with this PHET simulation, if we move the moon closer to the Earth, you can see the force is increasing. It has greater strength. And as we move it away, it becomes less. How else could we change the gravitational field strength? Well, we could increase the mass of the moon. It's a greater force. We could increase the mass of the Earth as well, and there's going to be a greater gravitational field strength, and it's going to have catastrophic consequences when we put it in orbit. And so remember, any object that has mass is going to generate a gravitational field, and those field lines are going to point to the center of that object. And so any object, and we'll just deal with spherical objects in AP Physics 1, is going to have a gravitational field that's going to become greater the closer we come to that object. And so if you want to calculate the gravitational field strength, this equation works. And it was developed by Sir Isaac Newton. And it really only has those two things that we saw in that video. It's the mass of the object, and then the radius, or the distance between that object and a point. Now, you might say there's three things in this equation. The first one is a gravitational constant. We lots of times refer to that as big G. But the other two things that are going to affect the gravitational field strength are the mass of the object and then the radius, or the distance from the object. And so in this class, you should be able to calculate the gravitational field strength of an object or sitting on the surface of a really large object like the planet. And so gravitational field strength, this is our equation right here. There are three parts to it. And so if we're measuring the gravitational field strength at a point separated from that object, we need to know the mass of the object. We need to know the radius. And note this, that when we're looking at the radius, it's not from the surface of the object. It's from the center of mass of both objects. In this case, one is just a point. And then the last one is going to be the gravitational constant, or big G, and that's just 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11th. And then we got a bunch of units coming in after that. And so let me give you an example problem. Let's say I want you to figure out the gravitational field strength of a baseball. You could imagine it's going to be really, really small. There's not much mass in it. But if you want to solve this problem, I haven't given you enough information. You need to know what's the mass of that object. It's 0.145 kilograms. And you also have to know how far away is it. And let's say it's 2.0 meters. And so you maybe have forgotten what big G is, so we'll put that right up there. 6.67 times 10 to the negative 11th. And so you may want to pause the video right now and try to solve this problem. Or you could just watch me do it. I'm going to take those three values and I'm going to place them into my equation. So I'm taking the big G times the mass divided by the radius squared. And so when I solve that, I get a gravitational field strength, or a G, of 2.4 times 10 to the negative 12 newtons per kilogram.
All right. So I want to stop it right there, because I want to point out something that Poindexter here is saying about these field strengths, right? So he does the math and he comes up with 2.4 times 10 to the negative 12th newtons per kilogram. Okay, so what they're doing then is they're actually applying things that should be measurable to something that is conceptual, right? Well, if we actually look at that and we say, all right, well, how much energy is in a newton, right? Let's just ask that, okay? So it says 1 newton is the force required to accelerate 1 kilogram of mass at 1 meter per second. The newton meters are termed joules. The joule is named after James Prescott Joule, who first calculated the amount of electrical work needed to produce a unit of heat. All right, great. So let's look at a joule, right? And let's look at some of the conversions that we can make. Let's look at it to a watt hour, right? That is a watt hour. And of course, watt is the equation as P equals IE, power equals currents times voltage. This is a very small value, but it's definitely measurable. Or you can take it as the electron volt. Well, essentially what that is, this figure right here, 6.242 times 10 to the 18th, is also defined as a coulomb or 1 ampere, right? 1 ampere is defined by this many electrons passing by a certain point in a conductor in 1 second, all right? So 1 ampere is actually quite a bit of power, right? Or quite a bit of, I should say, electrostatic charge, and it's very measurable. So if you were to take this and go back to Poindexter's formula here, right? Then that tells us that we should have a significant amount of charge potential that we can measure in this so-called gravitational field. Well, isn't it interesting that they're using something that is charge potential? And you know what? We can measure charge potential in the air. And that, of course, goes back to the 100 volts per meter of voltage that we can measure going from the Earth ground up. But where is gravity in this? Where is the gravitational field? What they're doing is they're using math, and they are using units that are directly related to electricity and magnetism. There is nothing in here about gravity. This is all complete fantasy. So I just wanted to point that out, and let's hear out the rest of what Poindexter has to say here. But this is just utter nonsense. Here we go.
Bob, one question would be, you know, like the electron, do they conceive of it as a particle or as a current?
They conceive of electron as a particle. However, if you look at it more in the Walter Russell or Ken Wheeler or Nikola Tesla, it's more of a, I think Austin describes it better, as a sampling of the Austin, how do you describe it? You describe it better than I do.
Just the terminal end of 1 unit line of dielectric induction. So it's just like a dielectric line of induction. It's got little gaps in it, and then they quantify the gaps as some physical mm-hmm. particle.
Beautiful. Exactly. That's what he said. Thank you, Austin. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
All right. So
very interesting. And then what you're seeing here is whereas like gravity should have nothing to do with electric fields or magnetic fields.
Well, they say that. They say that, but then they turn around and use the very measurements for electricity. That's the absurd part about it. It's like, really? Where's the gravitational field? Well, you'd have to use a LIGO facility to measure that and watch something decrease by the 1,000th of a width of a proton. Oh, my God. Give me a break.
And how easy is it to measure electric stuff? Like, it's very simple. You can get a machine that does it, right?
You can use your phone to do it. Your phone will do it.
Yeah.
That's how unbelievably common it actually is. So let's hear out Poindexter here for a couple more minutes, and then we'll cease this nonsense.
Cancel out all those units. We've got newtons on the top. We've got kilograms on the top, but we've got kilograms squared on the bottom. So we're going to end up with 1 kilogram on the top, and then the meter squared are going to cancel out. And so that's going to be the gravitational field strength of the baseball. Incredibly small, but it's still there. Let's say we were to do this. Can you figure out the gravitational field strength of the Earth? So we're sitting on the surface of the Earth. Can you figure out what's the strength of that force pulling you or holding you on the planet? Well, again, you'd need two more things. We're going to need to know the mass of the Earth, and it's pretty massive, 5.97 times 10 to the 24th kilograms.
Yeah, okay.
And you also need to know how far are you from the center of the Earth? What's the radius of the Earth? And it's 6.37 times 10 to the 6 meters. And so to solve this problem, you're going to do the same exact thing. We're going to plug it into those equations, those values. And again, it's worth doing, but if you do this, you're going to get a value that you've seen before. The gravitational field strength is going to be 9.81 newtons per kilogram. And so that is going to be the gravitational field strength as we get close to the planet. Again, it's also numerically equal to the acceleration due to gravity on our planet. And you might say it's going to be the same everywhere on our planet, but it's not. If you look at the gravitational field strength on our planet, and this is a NASA image, it's going to vary depending on where you are. Because the Earth isn't consistent, it's not a consistent sphere with consistent density, it's going to have different...
You know, doesn't that seem to run counter to what they were saying earlier? If the mass is not changing, if the total mass is still the same, then why would the composition or the configuration of that mass make any damn difference at all?
Absolutely. He was talking about the center of it being the important thing, and it was going to be the same before he made that point before. He had the diagram, right? And now we have something that doesn't fit it.
That's right. And now on the flat Earth, of course, or, you know, whatever, you know, by gravimeters, or, you know, gravimeters being these accelerometers measuring differences in acceleration downward, right? We know that these anomalous areas exist. They absolutely do. So what causes them? Well, again, like I said before, when you look at these supposed gravimetrically anomalous areas, what do you have? You have magnetic fields that are also anomalous, and most likely, and I haven't seen anybody actually take a charge measurement in the area, but I would bet the farm that there's also charge anomalies as well. So again,
should those also shift according to how the ether might be moving?
Yes. Yes, indeed. That would absolutely stand to reason, because everything is in motion. But their explanation for it is patently absurd. Makes no sense whatsoever. So about 30 more seconds of this, and then we're done with Poindexter.
Differences in latitude and therefore the distance from the center of the Earth. There's going to be geological differences, what the Earth is made up of. And so we can study the gravitational field strength in different areas, and it tells us a lot about what the Earth is actually made of. And so did you learn to calculate the gravitational field strength of an object a certain distance away? And did you figure out how to approximate the gravitational field strength if you're sitting on the surface of a really large object? It's the same equation. It's pretty easy, and I hope that's helpful.
Well, thank you, Poindexter. No, that wasn't helpful at all, except for showing us that your model is full of BS. So, anyway, all right. So, again, like I said, the calculations, they use the electrical and magnetic calculations. They use electrical and magnetic units of measurement. And yet, these have nothing to do with so-called gravity unless they finally fess up and say the attractive or the acceleration is caused by an electrical force, which they're never going to do that. And that's you know, part of the biggest problem with this. So that...
And then you had the other professor saying that at the micro level, it's all electricity. And then at a certain point, where is the transition zone where it becomes gravity, right? Did they talk about that?
Yeah. No, they don't.
Yeah, and Bob, I sent over a couple of things. It's the three-body problem. It's an illustration. So they taught this planetary orbital motion based on gravity, the theory or hypothesis of gravity. And if you see what the results are fed into computers with all of the numbers from Newton and everybody, they just don't work. They don't look like we see planetary motion. And the solutions that they come up with, there's only, well, it's arguable whether they're actual solutions to the quote problem. It's, again, not anything that looks like what we've been taught orbital dynamics should be. And going on their mathematics.
It is very much, though, what we've suspected, and I think what you talked about also before, how the distance between the planets in their model, by shifting throughout the year, should shift all the orbits, which is what you're showing here.
Yeah, and it throws it out of balance, out of whack. Right. It's in three-dimensional space, and over time, it just makes a spaghetti diagram, unless you find, okay, these are the supposed solutions. And the one on the left, I'm not clear. It's not clear to me how that's a solution. It doesn't look like anything I've ever been shown as how anything orbits.
Looks like a kindergartner right, scribbling with a crayon.
Yeah, it's a mess. It's a mess. And this is a three-body problem. It's not a four-body problem or a five-body problem. Or so whatever their models are, it's just an absolute joke that these equations, the gravitational equation for the main one, could explain what we are seeing. And they can throw in dark energy and dark matter, but is an absolute it's just a cop out, really. I guess it just, to me, I don't know if it's supposed to actually address this issue. I think they have some frames of reference explanations, but that's an assumptive basis. It's just another thing to make you walk away from the heliocentric model, in my opinion.
Yep, shaking your head.
What's so funny is when I was a kid, I remember thinking that it didn't make sense that the Earth was being pulled in by the gravitational pull of the Sun and the Moon was being pulled in by the gravitational pull of the Earth, but of course the Sun's is way stronger. And so if you do it, even just, you know, factoring in the proportionate nature, it's like, okay, well, either the Moon's going to be going further away from the Earth or the pull of the Earth's going to be stronger due to the relative distances, and it's going to be getting closer to the Earth, and it would be pretty significant. What are the odds of it being perfect to where we see it there the same? Like, I didn't – in high school, I remember being like, that doesn't even make sense, and I thought, okay, that seems too simple. I can't ask that question, right?
Right. Yeah. Well, and think about this, Austin. You know, by going by their logic, if the Sun truly had a strong enough gravitational field to hold the Earth within its boundaries, right, its orbital boundaries around the so-called Sun, then you would think that you would weigh not just a little more, but a whole crap ton more at nighttime, right? When you're away from the Sun and you've got the entire Earth that's in between you and the Sun, right?
Yeah, exactly. And if you play football on one side of the Earth, you know, you're going to be able to throw it across the field effortlessly, and it would be completely different on both sides of the Earth.
Yes, but they, you know, again, what they do, they say, oh, no, you flat earthers are dumb. The math says this. It's like, yeah, but you know what? Common sense says something completely different. And again, show me the gravitational field. Show me a measurement of it. Not a description of it, of what it does, but show me a measurement of it. I can show you a measurement of a magnetic field. I can show you a measurement of a static, electrostatic field. You show me a measurement of a gravitational field. And you know what? It can't happen because it doesn't exist. Period. And that's what I got to say about that.
Amen.
All right. Cool.
Well, you know, something else is that they added the distances to wash that away, you know, with what you said. Because Austin, when I was a kid, I thought, like, well, they should hold the Olympics, like the high jump and everything, when the moon's overhead, you know, at noon, and you have all that extra pull, and you can, you know, kiss your fingers and look up and put your hand up to the sky, to the sun and the moon, because they're going to pull you up for that world record. And you go and you do your jump, and it's just epic, you know. Whereas if it were at night or whatever, you know, you'd be like slammed down and, you know, miss your qualifications or whatever. So it's like, no, it doesn't factor in, you know. It's the extremes of the differences in mass and the great distances involved and blah, blah, blah. But it just doesn't hold up. Yeah.
Exactly. And, you know.
Right. They added all those distances to basically like the crazy distances to try to make it unfalsifiable, but it still is falsifiable. Like even with that, it isn't a sufficient explanation if you really think about it. So, you know, it's just kind of wild world, clown world.
Yeah. So to bring this full circle and back to my original point that I have really, really been trying to get across to people, okay, is that this downward acceleration that is a small bias, just a small bias that determines up from down that the mainstream calls gravity, right? It exists. Now, if you want to rename all the rest of it something else, that would probably be a good idea. The fact that the mainstream has corrupted it and tried to apply it to all this other stuff is exactly the reason why flat earthers are saying, oh, it's horseshit, it doesn't exist at all. But a part of it does exist, and to summarily dismiss this, in my opinion, is a mistake. We need to address it on its merits, just like what we did today, showing that yes, we're not going to deny that there's a downward acceleration that is determining up from down. That much is a foregone conclusion. It's obvious. But when you extend that out, that reasoning, the math, the thought, the concept out any further than simply a simple up from down determination, it is incredibly flawed. That is what we need to be attacking, people, not whether or not that force is actually there, because it is. But it does not apply. It is a non sequitur to anything other than determining up from down. And that is the position I have had literally since the very first show that Jaron and I ever did together. I said in that show that buoyancy and density absolutely explain everything, but there is still something determining up from down. I have never changed from that position, and I never will, because that's the way it is.
Have you read about the Gestalt experiments when they put the subject with a lens in the eyes that inverts the world, makes the world upside down for the observer? So you put goggles on that invert everything. Suddenly you see everything upside down. And you can look it up if people have studied that. And at first there's a like incredible confusion. It is compared to paradigm shifts in a way, but quickly the person readjusts to living with the inverted view somehow.
Yeah, your brain just flips it again.
Somehow flips it, yeah. So yeah. That's another interesting thing.
Wizard goggles.
Exactly. So, okay, guys, so that's... Oh, go ahead, UAP.
Well, it's kind of unrelated, but with the mention of wizardry and paradigm shifting and everything, this... movie from George Milieu, the 1902 or 03 Fly Me to the Moon or whatever. You know what I'm talking about with the weirdo face with like the bullet in its eye, the moon.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yes.
You know what I mean? That really old, it's like the first sci-fi movie, whatever.
Yep, the moon with the missile in its eye or bullet in its eye. Exactly. I know what you're talking
about. Yeah, yeah. Well, there's a scene in there where the scientists are getting ready. It's like right in the beginning, and what they're doing is they're formulating their plan of going to the moon. But the scientists, when it starts out, are wizards. They're dressed traditionally like cartoonish, like wizards with the cloaks and capes, the star and moon patches sewn on, and the pointy hat and the whole get up, you know, magic wands, the whole thing. And they have this meeting, and they draw on the chalkboard a globe, and then they draw the moon and they draw that orbit thing, you know, the swirly orbit that we've seen drawn even in recent times, like showing how the astronauts got to the moon. And then they have a graduation. They exchange their wizard caps for the what's it called? The mortar. What is it called? The graduation hat. You know, the flat one with the tassel.
Yeah.
They get those.
Tassel and mortar or something like that. Yeah, I forgot what it's called, but you're right.
Yeah, and they get that, and the black cloaks, just like everybody has to wear. You know, basically what you're doing when you graduate, you're putting on the modern day wizard garb. Because you have been trained at Hogwarts or whatever school you went to, Princeton or whatever. Yeah. And it's just amazing that they tell you what they're doing right in your face through this like medium of art, and then they do it. And it's just funny that you can see that and not realize or appreciate what it really is saying. And it actually happened, you know, all of it, all of it happened because they made it seem like they were going to the moon. It was a stage set and everything. And that's exactly what happened. And yep. It was like the first of the first movies, like that wasn't the only one. There were a whole bunch of them. Edison had quite a few, and they were all like Alice in Wonderland. And then there was moon, like going to the moon. That was like a huge percentage of the very early movies. They even had one to Mars, very early, like 1907 or something like that. But anyway, I just...
What was the one that had the first rocket going up with a countdown? Is that 1910? Is it...
I don't know. They had something. They had something akin to like a countdown. It was more of like a shot, like a moon shot, they used to call it, where... It's like a barrel of a gun, and they send it up. That was the one. The ones that I saw did it like that, but I didn't see a rocket one.
I think it's also early on with the countdown. I think it comes from a film.
Because it's funny how the countdown thing is so associated with NASA and rocket launches, and you don't normally see adults getting together and shouting out a countdown to something like that.
Unless it's New Year's Eve.
it's just not it's kind of a funny thing to do. It's like to dramatize it, but
some people say it's the counting backwards, which is a satanic kind of practice. People point that out.
Okay,
inversions.
So let's go ahead and move on from that, and I'm going to cover one more thing before we call it a show. And didn't get a chance to cover this last week, but I thought it was funny. This article here, human missions to Mars will use lasers to communicate with Earth. Okay, now the reason I find this so humorous is...
I need one of those lasers.
Yeah, right?
Jaron, you were saying that before, like if you hold it at any appreciable distance, it's just impossible to keep that thing steady.
A nice powered laser going 4 miles, you know, has a beam divergence of... like 10 feet. So go ahead and figure that out to Mars, see what the beam divergence would be to cover the entire universe, I think.
Exactly. Well, and of course, they will say that their lasers are way, way, way orders of magnitude better. And of that, I won't dispute. But they are not that much better to the point where they could literally hold a pencil-thin beam going a billion miles away, right? And the other thing that you have to think about this, well, let me read a little bit about this. What this says first. It says, ever since NASA launched the Explorer 1 satellite in 1958, the agency has relied mostly on radio waves to communicate with craft millions or indeed billions of miles across space. But as NASA sets its sight on new destinations for manned missions, it is giving its communication system a much-needed overhaul. NASA is adding a new dish to its deep space network, equipped with mirrors and special receiver to allow it to beam and receive lasers from spacecraft in deep space. The new antenna dish, dubbed Deep Space Station 23, DSS-23, is part of a transition to a faster, bullshit faster, more efficient communication as NASA prepares for a return to the moon by the year 2024 and sets up for the first human mission to Mars in the mid-2030s. The impetus behind the dish is simple. If NASA is to send humans to Mars, they need to be able to communicate with them, and lasers could help ensure future Martian astronauts have a good reception 40 million miles from Earth. Okay, so
did they say impetus or impotence of the dish?
Yeah, well, impotence would be more applicable, I think. But so what they're saying here is that they're constructing this dish that is going to be basically a parabolic optical parabola. Okay, and the crazy thing about this is the first thing they say is that it's going to be faster. Well, I'm sorry, but laser light travels the same speed as RF light, so how in the world it could possibly be faster is ridiculous. That's absurd, and it's not true, and it's just a line of BS, okay? And if there was any difference between EM in the gigahertz range and light, which is in the nanometer range, it would be indistinguishable, frankly. Okay, so that's the first fallacy that they're coming up with. The second thing is they think that by having an optical parabola here, in other words, the concept behind this is as light is going to come into this dish and bounce back through the mirrors to the feed horn or collector point or some sort of an optical sensor, right? And this is going to give them a specific amount of gain to the laser. Well, I'm still failing to see how it would be any better than RF, but let's continue to look at this. So even if they were able to get a far sharper, more pencil-like beam than they could with a high-gain microwave antenna or anything like that, you still have to take into consideration that when they fire that beam from Mars, you've got at least 4 or 5 minutes of transit time. And during that transit time, the Earth, you know, whipping through at 67,000 miles an hour, plus, you know, ultimately culminating at 1.3 million miles per hour. And I'm sorry, NASA fanboys, the frame of reference is not going to work here. That's nonsense. It's not going to work. All right. You're receiving station is going to be far out of the optical aiming that's using. So what would they have to do? They would have to then anticipate then where the Earth is going to be, and they would have to constantly make calculations based on that on multiple different motions, right? So again, and then we have to look at the laser on the transmitting side. Well, what about beam divergence? We all know that there's a huge issue with beam divergence, right? From, you know, Jaron's simple laser that he had a hard time keeping less than a 10-foot diameter over the distance of a couple of miles. Well, even if they use really, really, really good lasers, they're still going to have one hell of a beam divergence going over millions, if not a billion miles, depending on the position of Earth and Mars, apart from each other, right? So we still are going to have beam divergence. We don't really know ultimately where the bulk of that signal is going to wind up. Earth is going to be far away from its initial target length. And, you know, they're trying to, you know, bypass all of this. I'm sure they're going to say, oh, frame of reference, that'll make it all right, all okay, but it won't. And common sense will tell you that it won't. So
it doesn't make any sense to me anyway. It's just when you look at the laser that they supposedly bounce off the moon, think of the size of that thing and think of the power. That it doesn't have to have a lot of power to generate a beam like that. I mean, maybe I'm wrong about that, but I mean, a 40 watt light bulb, you know, can just shine in the room, but a 40 watt laser, wouldn't that go through a house?
It would, but it would take a lot more than that to travel a billion miles, right?
Right.
Yeah. And remember that they claim they communicate with the Voyagers, and that's 13 trillion miles away or something like that.
It's not trillion. It's billions, though. It's billions. A big figure.
And so if that's the case and they do it with the power of refrigerator light bulb with radio, why would they need this laser?
Yeah, right. No kidding. So anyway, I'm just saying that, you know, they're trying to come up with something that's new and improved and better, and it's still absurd. You know, light still has to obey the inverse square law. They don't have enough power out there, you know, anywhere from, 100 million miles away to a billion miles away. They simply don't. To be able to generate that intense of a beam, to keep it focused. And, you know, the idea of focusing it on the receive end through a parabola is just stupid, frankly. It's not going to make that much difference. So I don't see any advantage whatsoever to going laser over RF. In fact, I see a lot of detriments to it. So
with that part, they can cut the Earth in half.
Yeah, that's it. The Death Star. and not only that, then you have refraction problems, you know, that you necessarily wouldn't have. You know, if you're using light or near visible light, you know, what kind of packet errors are you going to get from this journey, this beam divergence, all these other distortion factors that are going to go through? Sure, lasers would work great, you know, close proximity. And you would probably have a fairly reliable signal, but we're talking about replacing radio frequencies with an optical phenomena that is susceptible to a whole host of other problems. It's just ridiculous again, but this is just another one of those things that, you know, people, the fanboys eat it up. Oh yeah, it's gotta be better. We're going to use lasers. Wow. That's space age. So,
yeah, I think the reason they're doing it is the amount of data that can be transferred via laser versus whatever they're using now.
Right.
Well, yeah. But
yeah, and so they have plans, I think. They're actually going to pull off something, some kind of a stunt like they did in 69 through 72.
Right. Well, and yeah. I see what you're saying. They're saying that because of the fact that light is up in the nanometer band, that they can modulate that to a much broader bandwidth. I get that. But again, they've also then gone ahead and introduced, you know, susceptibilities like, you know, refractive problems, light diminishing, you know, when you go at these higher frequencies, the distances diminish. So I don't know. I just see a lot of problems with the UAP.
Yeah, I agree. It's absolutely impossible. Absolutely.
Yeah, if it's possible in a static system, I guess that's what you're saying, right, UAP, that it is possible maybe here on the Earth to make it faster and so on with lasers and fiber optic or whatnot, but then with all the motion.
I think their plans are such that they're going to have video and different things that are sent that would not be possible with the current usages. So they have to set up this thing through the Deep Space Network, which exists only to be the lone receiver. So it's one of these things where you can't hear it, you can't see it, you can't detect it, you can't pick it up on your equipment. Only the DSM can, and that's why it exists. It's like it's like having Pence audit Trump. It's pointless, but they need to do it.
And beyond that, UAP, think about this. I mean, even that they're using gigahertz microwave signals that are transmitting back, which should be able to easily host broadband video, right? And a huge data spectrum behind it, right? And yet they claim, well, we can't send any video back because we don't have enough bandwidth. It's like, what? So this is supposed to solve that problem? If you can't modulate onto a 2-3 gigahertz or 10 gigahertz microwave carrier enough bandwidth to carry a simple video signal, you got problems. You know, it's just none of it makes any sense. So anyway,
I found it pretty hilarious that if they don't even understand the characteristics of light, they could ever efficiently use it to do anything.
Agreed. Absolutely agreed. So anyway, that's all I want to say about that. I think we're going to wrap it up, guys. Karen B had to drop. So thank you, Karen, for coming on with us. And so if there's nothing else with you guys.
I got to run first.
Okay. I'll let you close out then. You're welcome.
Thanks for having me on, and I'll have a video that's being disputed. If I get it through, I'll post it. But other than that, just working on my book, trying to finish that up as promised. So that's it. Thanks everybody, and we'll see you next time.
All right, sounds good. Thanks for joining us, UAP, and we'll see you later. So let's swing around to Eero. Eero, you want to give us a little quick report on what's going on?
Yes, of course. Recently just finished the conference, so sorry for my absence during the show. I'm started with you guys, and then I need to cut off because I need to drive my YouTube channel with OBS and that kind of technical stuff. But it was really nice. This is the second day. The conference started yesterday. Of course, it's not the type of conference that you maybe think in terms of the International Flat Earth Conference, not that kind of conference. Even it's not the kind of conference that I made anytime that I go to Spain. But it's more, you know, close in terms of the relationship between people. There are people that came from United States. There is a guy, I always forget the name, but he's part of the speakers. He talks about a little bit about the poisons in the food, in the water, and that kind of stuff. And then we have an architect that give some part of the, you know, technical stuff behind, at least in terms of perspective, you know, that kind of not technical, but you know, an architect is not the same as a physicist, maybe, or an astronomer, but it has a very extensive knowledge in terms of the horizon perspective and that kind of thing. Yeah. We have also talks about history. A lot of guys talks about history. We have we present an experiment with the people that are the behind the Art Flat, which is our, you know, Spanish group equivalent to FA Core, presenting an experiment with a pendulum, but not gyroscope or just a tiny pendulum. I mean a very not super huge pendulum, but you know, a pendulum hanging on the building with 40 meters and trying to detect this motion, supposedly the difference motion between the day and the night with respect to the circling the sun. And they present all the measurements, and well, of course there is no I'm going to make some kind of a spoiler, but there you know, it's like we are not moving around the sun. So, you know, that kind of stuff, and the rest is just in terms of people get together and, you know, share information and that kind of stuff. So was a really nice. It was about like 6 hours, and tomorrow we're going to have another 6 hours. So I'm going to transmit tomorrow too. And
where
that's
is this
it.
Going on, Iru?
Excuse me?
Where is it happening?
In Cologne. In Cologne, Buenos Aires. Yes, the place is called like Columbus. That is the nice thing. So we don't have too much media like we had the last year, but at least we are still doing this kind of conference. So that's very nice.
Awesome. Well, that's great, Eero. So you're going to broadcast tomorrow on it as well. That's super. And maybe you can give us a full report on everything that happened next week. But
yeah, in fact, the guy from United States, he got he gave the conference in English. There is a woman who translated, but at least that tiny part is in English. I don't know tomorrow what he's going to talk about it. I believe he's going to change the topics, but that part at least is in English. The rest, unfortunately for you guys, is in Spanish, but we can give some kind of report.
Awesome. All right, cool. Well, thank you very much for that report, Eero, and we'll look forward to hearing the rest of it when you get a chance.
Okay.
All right, cool. So let's spin around, I guess, to Rodrigo. What do you got coming up this next week?
Well, just continue what I do. I don't know exactly where. There's so much going on. But yeah, continuing the magazine. There's some people who want to help, some designers. offer their help. We'll see if I take that offer and then continue with Spacecrack and the other idea, the Aetius report, right? There's a new one, which it's about a historical sighting of mountains in the distance. And he is reconstructing that in a model and saying at the end, concluding that it's impossible on a ball. So, but he does it in a way that's quite empirical. And since he's been sharing that, I think I'm going to share it with everyone. So it's similar to the first one, if you've seen that. And yeah, thank you for having me. And this has been very instructive. Thanks everybody, Austin and Jaren and Iru and Karen, who lost her bird. I'm sorry to hear that, Karen. She said she had to go because her bird died
for 17 years. No. Terrible. Oh, that's so sad. Charlie Bird is a little cockatiel. Oh, man, I'm sorry to hear that.
You met him.
I did meet him, yes. He was a very cute little cockatiel. He couldn't fly, but boy, talk about personality. Yeah, sorry to hear that, Karen. That's bad. So, okay. All right, so I guess, Austin, you would be up next, sir. What do you got coming up this week?
Just the live streams per usual, and then I'm actually trying to set up a sit down with a couple professors. I don't know if it's going to manifest, so it's just purely just potent possible, but atom physicist and an astrophysicist. I'm trying to get in the door with a sit down that maybe I can document. Then I have a couple groups of people that are wanting to go out and talk to the public about Flat Earth. So those two things are coming pretty soon, but as of now, just the lives, and I'll try and like keep everyone updated as I figure those out.
Okay, beautiful. Well, we'll look forward to seeing that. And I really enjoy your shows, Austin. And I think you and I should definitely, possibly occasionally do a show together talking about some of the more Ken Wheeler-ish type of things. I think that would be fun. A lot of people have requested that. So I think it'd be kind of a good idea.
Yeah, I agree. I'm definitely down, man.
All right. Sounds like a plan. All right. And last but certainly not least, Jaren, what do you got coming up?
Same old, same old. Raw tomorrow, obviously Thursday with Iru. Another lounge on Friday. So, and then also got a video coming out because the Flat Earth, Sun, Moon, and Zodiac clock app has some new features. And I think only Android is out right now. iOS will be a few more days, I think. And when it's out, David and I will release a feature review or a feature update video. So that should be this week. He's just waiting, I think, for the iOS version to get final approval. And I guess that a few people have already contacted David complaining basically about a subscription pop-up that he added to the app. And the thing is, you can go into settings and then turn off that alert, as far as I know. Again, I don't have the app yet the new features because I have iOS. So if you don't want to support the app, that's fine. Turn it off for me. Hey, I want to support Dave. I think he does a great job. He did an awesome job with the app, and it's 99 cents. So I'm going to hit subscribe. I won't even notice that I'm subscribing 99 cents a month at all. So it allows him to continue to work on it and pay the bills, basically. He does have to pay, like, every time he changes anything, obviously. And then also, I think, for weather updates, he gets, like, a monthly bill. So he's in this for thousands of dollars, and basically you could help him out. So long story short, if you don't want to support it, just turn it off. Go into the settings and click, I don't know what the button's going to say. Like I said, I don't have the app. Turn off subscription notification or something. It's meant for those who would like to help Dave and support his work. Maybe I'll be the only one, but I'm okay with giving David 99 cents a month. And if you don't want to, go to settings and turn it off. So that's about it. That video will be coming this week as soon as iOS confirms it. But if you have Android, you've already got it. So you actually would be better equipped to know how the settings work. But I think if you go to settings, there's somewhere that will say turn off subscription if you don't want to contribute.
Yep. Beautiful. Yeah, I'm definitely going to support it.
Yeah, 99 cents. Hey.
Yeah.
And Dave does work, and every time he calls and tries to add something or whatever, it's like hundreds of dollars, if not thousands. I don't know. He doesn't tell me the exactitudes of it all. It's his app. It's his baby. It's what he's spent a lot of time on and effort, and the way that you get a video update every day, and the way to keep the video archives, and he does all that work. So he's just looking for, another thing about David, he's really never asked for anything. So I'm just saying that from a personal standpoint. So if there's some little app way that I can just hit subscribe and 99 cents comes out of my bank account that's tied to Apple or whatever each month, I'm going to do it. And, but I understand some people out there might be like, I don't want to do that. And that's completely understandable. Just
don't
turn
have
off.
To. Yep, right. Exactly.
Support what you like or it goes away. That's all.
Exactly. And yeah, I mean, I also know that David asked me to ask the guy that developed the Bob Wins app to make a change to it. And hopefully he'll be doing that soon so it comes up on a specific screen. But he is going to, or maybe he already has incorporated the Bob Wins flat Earth map, the basic takeoff from the null skull map. That's going to be on there. So anyway, super. Okay, so yeah, definitely I would support that, guys. It's only $1 a month, you know, no big deal, 99 cents. So I think it's worth it. And coming up next after this show, I believe Crow 777 and Jason will be doing a show. So mods, if you would be so happy, be so kind as to spam that link, and everybody can run over there and check out Code 777 and Jason Lindgren on their show. They do a fabulous job and a fabulous show. You know, Jaron and I think all of us are big fans and supporters of Crow and Jason. We really like their work, and we think you will too. So coming up immediately after Globebusters, I believe in about 5 minutes, it will be starting. So yeah, there you have it, guys. So if there is nothing else, let's go ahead and call it a show. We'll see you guys next week. And thanks for joining us, everybody. Let me check one more thing really quick to do any shout outs. Let's see if there were any additional super chats that I may have missed. It doesn't look like it. I think I got them all. So we will see you guys next week. Appreciate y'all. Love y'all. And thanks for being with us today. Until then, be good to each other. Don't lie to each other. Open your mind, because there's truth inside. Peace out, everybody.
Peace.
Peace.